Imad Khan Rahami's father back in 2014, more than 2 years ago, told the police and the FBI that his son was a terrorist who was traveling to the Middle East to learn how to attack the West. So as usual, it is a false flag. And by false flag, it doesn't mean that radical Islam or Orthodox Islam or Wahhabist Islam isn't on the march and isn't one of the greatest threats to civilization and culture. That's absolutely true. But our government and Western governments have opened up the doors to bring these people in and to protect them and then to cover up the fact that it's terrorism. And they call it a war on narratives when in reality, the White House and the PR people are at war with reality and the truth. That's what they call it, is a war on a narrative. So they spin it around, like changing the name of Al-Qaeda when it came out that our government was funding it and supporting it all over the Middle East and Africa and in Syria and in Egypt. When that all came out, they go, okay, our troops are upset. They know what's going on. Let's change the name. Congress is investigating. Let's change the name to ISIS, which is the Islamic State that is part of Iraq and Syria, a new home base they've carved out for Al-Qaeda, which is just another name, which means the base. Again, it's all a big joke. It's Wahhabis out of Saudi Arabia, and their last name, started in the early 80s, is called Al-Qaeda, which means the base or the homeland, and now their new name is IS, Islamic State, even clearer. Al-Qaeda, the base. IS, the Islamic State, the base. Same black flag, same funding, same people. In fact, I wouldn't use the parable or the analogy or the comparison of my dad is a Jones and then I'm his son. We're closely related. Because ISIS is not the son of Al-Qaeda. ISIS and Al-Qaeda are the sons of the House of Saudi and the Wahhabist. They are brothers. Now, that's the best breakdown of it you're going to get, period. Because I've studied it in depth. That's why Donald Trump was meeting last night with the Egyptian president, one of the most populous Middle Eastern countries in the world, one of the most populous nations, period, in that whole region. And they've been an ally of the West and been what I'd call good Muslims, prosperity, basic freedom compared to the other areas in the region, letting Christians and others live in peace, letting tourists come, not letting the radical Muslims kill everybody. Obama overthrows all that. CNN says it's wonderful 5 years ago. Remember all that? The Arab Spring? Turning Wahhabist Sunnis loose. The Muslim Brotherhood. IS. The base. Setting up their bases. Setting up their states. Setting up their Wahhabist Islamic republics. That's what they're doing. And they play games with the public who's ignorant. And the media criticizes him for meeting with them and saying, we're going to be allies with Egypt again, and we're going to help fight radical Islam with you. Meanwhile, when we come back, the mother of insanity, and Hillary actually agreed with her. Bloomberg, a reporter, asked Hillary, like desperately, is it the Russians? Are they bombing? Because we know that Islamic State and radical Muslims don't exist. I mean, we know there's nothing radical about Islam. It's the religion of peace. She actually says this, basically. So it's got to be the Russians bombing because Muslims never did that. No. And then Hillary goes, oh, yes. Oh, yeah. It's like an Aid Skrillex Carl the Cut skit or something. It's so over the top. They're like, oh, she goes, oh, yeah. Donald Trump's the one promoting this radical group, ISIS, that has nothing to do with Islam. And yeah, the Russians like him. So she pretty much agrees with the biggest conspiracy theory made up, moon is made of cheese, crap I ever heard. Thank you for joining us. It is September 20th, 2016 on this Tuesday edition. We're going to be live here for the next 4 hours. Roger Stone is joining us, coming up in the last 30 minutes of the third hour with a lot of big breaking news. I will also tell you that we are working on a surprise. I guess you could call it a a September surprise for Hillary and the globalists and George Soros that we should be breaking Thursday or Friday. That is big. I'm just going to leave it at that. And the story will go out one way or the other, no matter what happens to InfoWars. But believe me, these are the type of stories that are extremely dangerous. So we need your prayers and your support. We have the reported bomber in New York. We have his father coming out, and this is in the New York Times, saying that he told the police in 2014 his son was a terrorist, officials say. So that's Ahmed Khan Rahami's father went to the police, went to the FBI in 2014 when he knew that his son was traveling overseas to Pakistan and other areas, the classic story of going and being radicalized to become an asymmetrical warfighter known in the West as a terrorist. Now, I raise that point because we witnessed Hillary on Sunday, the day after we saw a bomb go off in New Jersey and a bomb go off in New York entering 29 and nine people being stabbed, three of them critically in a small town mall in Minnesota, we witnessed the controlled corporate press further discredit themselves and Hillary come out and further discredit herself and say, yes, I know about the bomb going off in New York and the bomb going off in New Jersey. And that's why we've got to continue to quote, go after the bad guys. And then 30 seconds later, CNN says, well, Donald Trump came out and called it a bomb. She goes, yeah, see, he's horrible. He's terrible. They're still on the news. CNN, MSNBC, Fox, even this morning, I was watching it, saying Trump jumped the gun. Because, you see, this is a big win for Trump, predicting it being right, calling it first. So they just invert all of that like it's a con game and just announce that it's, you know, a horrible thing that he saved a child from a burning building, hypothetically. Or it's terrible he saved a kitten out of a tree when a big storm was coming. It's terrible he gave charity to people. When someone's got positives, you don't even try to actually undermine the true story. You just brazenly attack it, even though it doesn't even make sense. In psychological warfare, it just changes the subject. That's what the media is doing. Just like they call it a war on narratives, saying that because we admit ISIS is attacking us, because we admit Al-Qaeda is attacking us, because we admit that radical Islam is in a major offensive jihad worldwide, invading 20-plus countries in the last 5 years alone, and our own globalist government financed and protected it and called it a peaceful revolution, the Arab Spring, launching it in Egypt and Tunisia in North Africa. The truth is the globalists have launched this with Saudi Arabia. The Russians have come out and said, we've never had a real ceasefire with you the last year. You're cheating. You're targeting Syrian forces. You're killing them almost on a daily basis. You are backing Islamic Wahhabist forces that have come here from around the world being run by Saudi Arabia. Stop it. The Russian generals have come out yesterday and said this again. And guess what? It's true. Criminal elements that run our government, the George Soros types, are openly running Wahhabist jihad worldwide. Now, Al-Qaeda is not the father of ISIS. It is the brother of ISIS. Saudi Arabia, Sunni Wahhabism is the mother and the father. But the modern military incarnations of this are Al-Qaeda, which was much smaller and more infiltrated by Western intelligence than the new ISIS system, which means Islamic State. Al-Qaeda means the base. Same thing. It is the Islamic base. It is the state. It is planting the flag. It is the invasion force. It is the declaration of living space, of Lebensraum, of taking over the world, of usurping you for Islam, of the Islamic State. And in this war on narratives, they think the public's so stupid. And look at Californians. Not one Californian our reporter talked to last week knew that the Trumps weren't really hunting Stegosaurus and Triceratops and Pterodactyls. People think that's a fake video. We're going to do one in Austin. I predict Austinites aren't as brain damaged as Californians, but they're close because they're so-called liberals. I am predicting half of the Austinites at UT, or the people at the University of Texas, we're going to go there in other Trinity areas, will believe that the Trump brothers, the Trump sons, are hunting Stegosaurus, are hunting Triceratops and Pterodactyl. Because you understand, everything the globalist does is pointed at low information morons like these people, who aren't deplorable. They're just sad little TV heads who have no culture, no future, no life, the opposite of a liberal, who believe they're liberal. They're moron, brainwashed idiots who have been given by the mainstream media the mantle of intellectual gods when they are nothing but drooling, sycophantic, foppish morons. And I don't say that with pleasure, but these are snot-nosed, dangerous authoritarians. And when our military starts coming out and General Flynn came out and said, we're backing Al-Qaeda, they're now known as ISIS, when the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, Dempsey, went to Obama 4 years ago and said, there's going to be a military revolt, they're not going to follow orders, do not bomb the Syrian regular army, or there's going to be a full revolt and we're going to Congress. Obama had to back off for about 2 years, rename it ISIS within weeks, and then launch this new Islamic invasion that's a ground force all over the world. And then Merkel opens up the border. They bring them all into Europe. Soros is in the news today. They've given $3 billion in the last 5 years to radical Islamic groups in the U.S. and Europe, and hundreds of millions to Black Lives Matter. Ford Foundation gave another $100 million 2 weeks ago. Soros is now pledging an additional $500 million to lobby for open borders in Europe and the United States. And of course, the media spins it as, oh, Soros is helping the sweet immigrants. You don't even call them invaders. You don't call them 80% military-aged men. You don't call them Wahhabists. You call them loving little friendly helpers. It's all orchestrated. It's all run. And there last night was Donald Trump meeting with General Flynn and Senator Sessions with the number one stabilizing force in the Middle East after Israel, but the main stabilizing force, not just in the Middle East, but also in Africa, Egypt, the biggest population of that entire region, saying, we're going to help take out the Wahhabists and the Muslim Brotherhood with you, and making a deal publicly to the New York Times to oppose the Islamic invasion, the Wahhabist invasion that criminal elements of our government with Hillary Clinton, Obama, and others have launched. I mean, Obama has personally, with his family, launched jihad invasions of Kenya, which has been 90% a Christian nation. Parts of Kenya have already fallen, like Sudan. It's happening, ladies and gentlemen. And Trump is being advised by the patriots like General Flynn, who was the main person orchestrating the military saying no to backing Al-Qaeda / ISIS. This is big. This is the counter coup. This is the soft coup against the globalist, against the leftist Goldman Sachs world government combine with Bloomberg and you know, all these other New World Order people working with Soros, the Rockefeller Foundation, the UN, you name it, to bring down the West. This is really happening. Russia has been encircled by the Islamist army the globalists are using. Europe is being openly invaded, and the sleeper cells are being put in place. Same thing with the U.S. and Canada. Russia dare fights back against it and says to the United States, let's combine forces and stop this together. And they're told no. But our military behind the scenes has, and Cy Hirsch has brought out that classified information. We're skipping this break. So this is the massive level of historical things that are happening. Not my opinion. Yes, you heard it here first 20 years ago, 15 years ago, 5 years ago, a year ago. Yes, we were spot on. Yes, we were on target. Because we have the sources and I do the research and we have the guest on and we understand who the bad guys are and who the good guys are, and we now know the battle plan. I thought they'd just use radical Islam to set up a police state in the United States and have excuses to invade the Middle East and go after the non-radical countries, which you've seen them do, and overthrow, like Egypt, like Libya, like Iraq. And compared to the Wahhabists, they're non-radical. But I thought it was to maybe use those as bases to take out the radicals. No, the globalists are so evil, They're actually doing that for the radicals to turn all of Islam into the most vicious system you could ever imagine, which is very, very close to happening. And then double-crossing the West and actually bringing in the Muslims by the tens of millions and making us submit to them. And the government will be the client manager of all the different disparate groups in the divide-and-conquer strategy. So it gets crazier. I'm going to play this clip first. So you have the father of the bomber, reported bomber, who reportedly admits he did it, going to the police 2 years ago and saying he plans to attack. You got to stop him, and they didn't. So if you ask where's the false flags, the White House has tied the hands of the FBI, the federal marshals, you name it. This is all on record. They're not even allowed to investigate mosques. They're not allowed to even prosecute Muslims when they create all sorts of problems and commit crimes. This guy had stabbed a family member, critically wounding him, 3 years ago, and had been let off, not even charged. Not even charged. Because it's a protected class. The radical Muslims are the detonator to destabilize everything. And that's what Soros says in his emails. Remember, this is no longer our expert opinion. This is confirmed in triplicate. So huge. And what do? They come out and they say, well, you know, we're just going to have to take more of your liberties and have the NSA spy on you. And it turns out the NSA isn't even spying on the jihadists, basically. It was all used as a way, again, to bring in the police state. Does that mean we hate the average cop? No. They're being enslaved as well. Not about police state. I mean multinational corporations running our infrastructure, spy grids, having kill switches and everything. This is the ultimate national security risk to America. This is how we got Trojan horse captured by an offshore technocracy that admittedly runs the NSA and the other 15 agencies now. We've been captured. It's happened. They staged the attacks with the radical Muslims, pass all these laws allowing a total 1984 control grid, put the system in place, and then phase two, dissolve our borders and bring in the very supposed threat that the police state was set up to counter. To then in phase two, manage those attacks from all the sleeper cells that are real and that are going to take action, order the FBI to not stop the attacks, let the attacks take place. This is all admitted now. And then dissolve everyone's freedoms and legitimize the 1984 total surveillance state. You've been given the plan before it happened, while it was happening, and now that we are up to our eyeballs in this swamp. Only admitting it is going to get us out of it, because here's the big enchilada. I would tell people 20 years ago they were going to come out with driverless cars and then raise insurance rates to where everything had to be driverless as a way to totally control society. And also during an economic collapse, the elite corporations will still have their robot cars and robot 18-wheelers running, so they'll have their own autonomous robot system with a very small group of humans to upkeep it, making all of us obsolete to be kept in our ghettos, basically, with all the new regulations and controls under Agenda 21, not letting us barter, not letting us plant crops, not letting us garden, not letting us machine shop or engage in metallurgy outside of their control. It's a total admitted takeover. Now, I saw it over the horizon. Now what I saw over the horizon is here and exactly as I saw it. Because I studied history, feudalism, technocracy, technotronic era, Brzezinski, the Kissinger Group, the Royal Commission on Population, what Google said it was going to... I mean, this is all public. And now they're in your face, throwing down the gauntlet, the New York Times, I have it here, and they say, U.S. signals backing for self-driving cars, and it says in the article, the feds are going to set it up where the highways are for driverless cars and not your cars and tax you and regulate you, forcing you, and this is an incredibly arrogant statement, within 5 years out of your cars. And you say, well, how are they going to pull that off? Because they're getting ready for a gigantic depression. Oh, that's the next shoe to drop. They have a big globalist professor writing a CNN article saying, I'm not going to tell you what it is, but a giant global crisis is about to happen within 1 month that will shake Trump and Hillary. Prepare yourself. And then people all speculate. There's an article on Infowars.com. You know, is it a jihad attack? You know, is it a big war that's about to happen? It's all of that. It's already happening. But it's going to be, unless they change plans, but currently it's already on, German bank collapse, which will then be followed by a huge banking crisis where they hold everyone hostage and say politically, do whatever we say and give us unlimited banker bailouts and control of your currencies even further and let it all be completely untransparent, or the stock market won't go back up. So that's what they say is coming. Bloomberg, Deutsche Bank goes to crisis era well. German banks say it's on the verge of total collapse. That's today. Now, the giant enchilada, the first clip of the day. I've laid out the spectrum of what we currently face. In their own words, George Soros captaining the whole thing. Proud man who told reporters 30 years ago he believed he was the Messiah. He believes he is the Messiah. But said, you can find the quotes, I had to get into power first or they would lock me up thinking I was insane. Ooh, see, it's not insane if he becomes the Messiah. See, the Messiah. A guy thinks he's the Messiah, was a Nazi collaborator when he was 15 years old, got rich off the Jews he helped find and ferret out. I mean, just think of the evil level of these people. And now, 500 million in this month alone to break our borders. Associated Press. And what do? They've claimed there's going to be no election fraud. Oh, there's going to be no problems. There's nothing going on. There's nothing happening. Alex is insane a month and a half ago. Then Trump comes out and says, no, we are going to investigate it. It's real. And then they come out and say the Russians have hacked the election computers. We have to hook into all of them with the OECD's paramilitary arm. The OECD is what founded the modern EU. The actual corporation, the Marshall Plan Corporation, is going to come here now and take us fully under its control. And they've now announced, ladies and gentlemen, that they believe that the Russians might try to come after Hillary Clinton. They're floating that. The Russians, if you believe that. When Hillary is a globalist, she is a conqueror. She is a general for the New World Order that is here sitting on us. She is the multinational queen. She is their agent. They are the outside group. We are conquered to a great extent. Now they want to mop up media, and they say the alternative right, those that will tell you the truth, have no right to exist. You're watching history happen because we're there opposing them. The last Americans, the last Europeans in Europe and others, people in other countries like Brazil are trying to block the globalists and being brought to their knees. They're bringing other countries to their knees. They're about to bring the UK to its knees because it dare declare sovereignty. And you have the UN making all the laws. You have all this global control. We have our borders being opened. And the people of England say, we never voted to enter you. We're going to get out. They vote to leave and they go, sorry, we're not letting you leave. And by the way, we're going to smash your economy and teach you not to try to leave us. These are authoritarians, people. These people are evil. And they're now dissolving Europe's borders to flood it with giant poor populations that they're going to have under their control. And running TV ads, state-run, saying it's bad to be German, it's bad to be Swedish, white people are bad, you must accept the hijab, Islam is your future. And they're advertising it all over Africa and the Middle East. Come here. We're open. And the Muslim imams say, they are weak. We take them now. We come. And Merkel and Hollande and all the leaders openly write articles saying, this is good. You're seeing the fall of Europe. They're actually admitting it. And I got to hand it to them. They're finally going to conquer Europe after the Middle East trying for thousands of years. It's actually happening. But, I mean, they ran Europe. What's wrong with Europe? They're just destroying it for fun, pissing on it, because these are deviants. And now, the big clip. I'm going to go to it as we go to break and then come back with the rest. Hillary Clinton asked by Bloomberg, are the Russians the ones behind the bombing? There is no radical Islam, even though his father says he did it. You're bad to say it, but ladies and gentlemen, Is it the Russians bombing? Because radical Islam doesn't exist, Hillary. I mean, they're peaceful, right? The Russians. I mean, this is the wild-eyedness of these people. And the guy that leads them, who thinks he's the Messiah. Here it is.
Are you concerned that this weekend's attacks or potential incidents in the coming weeks might be an attempt by ISIS or ISIS sympathizers or really any other group, maybe the Russians, to influence the presidential race in some way and presumably try to drive votes to Donald Trump?
Back it up at the start. I want to come back and play this in full without an interruption, but notice, she looks at that woman, they make eye contact, she doesn't do press conferences, she has chosen little deals every day or so, and she can get up for 10 minutes, look how sick she looks, to let them ask a few pre-scripted questions. That's admitted years ago. It's admitted in her emails that it's all scripted pre-questions. She gets ready for the scripted questions, so this is Hillary asking herself a question. That's news right there. And they slip in ISIS, Al-Qaeda, admitting, yeah, maybe they do terror, to make it sound more legitimate, and then slip in the Russians, see? All of it scripted, all of it engineered, admittedly so. All of it a conspiracy against the free world. Stay with us. You know, I play chess, and I play three-dimensional chess when I study politics and history. And a lot of people who think that Obamacare is free when it's not, and a lot of people who take Common Core classes and believe 2 + 2 = 5, they can't grasp some of the ideas we put out here. And I'm going to be honest. I don't say this in an elitist fashion. I don't say this from a position of enjoying the fact that the general public and even most so-called intellectuals, pseudo-intellectuals, don't know what they're talking about, don't really know about terms. They're very threatened by it. They don't like it. I'm into knowledge and history because it's incredibly interesting and because I don't want to be a slave. I fundamentally don't like reading hundreds and hundreds of books and hundreds of white papers where the globalists, and watching them on C-SPAN and TED TV and you name it, admitting everything they're doing to us and knowing that 95% of what I say came out of their mouths. And then I show you where they said it. And then the public goes, you're a conspiracy theorist. I choose not to believe that. Or they say, that's your interpretation. No, $100 trillion a decade global carbon tax to start that they admit is to end the industrialized world on a selective basis and only allow industry in select corporate reservations. That's called high-tech feudalism. And by the way, they call it a new form of feudalism in the United Nations Biological Diversity Assessment. I mean, you know, I remember reading this stuff, and it's like, this sounds like feudalism. They'd say, we will reestablish feudalism. And you're like, whoa. But again, the general public's like, oh, you're being fancy. Feudalism, what's that made-up word? You know, fag. And I use that, if you haven't seen, you know, Idiocracy, the guy was just average in the year 2020 or whatever. He goes forward 200 years, and people are so dumbed down, he's like the smartest person on the earth. And he goes into this court trial, and he goes, I'd like to put on some evidence. The judge goes, why don't you just sit down and stop talking like a fag? And I've actually seen people who will say, look at him. He's reading a book. I've actually been out at pools and stuff and seen guys walk by some other guy reading a book and go, oh, wow, reading a book. Must be really smart. Hey, girls, look. I mean, it's like a war on knowledge. And it's getting weirder and weirder. And weirder, because the more knowledge you get, the more you want, because then you just start figuring stuff out, and then you're more successful in life and business, and then all of a sudden, you're hanging around with the brainiacs of the planet. Instead, people think it's really cool to know nothing, or act like they do, and just laugh at everybody. But I'm here to tell you, a world government is being established that is designed to set up a planet where you don't exist. That's pretty diabolical. And they're now announcing in Bloomberg and the New York Times, hey, by 2025, there'll be no one allowed to drive on the roads. You're like, well, that'll never happen. The point is they're trying to break your will and just being the most extreme up front. We're building a world where humans don't run anything except the humans that set up the computers and control those. They're called technocrats. And the globalists call themselves technocrats at Davos and at Bilderberg and at the Club of Rome. And they talk about all these horrible things they're going to do. So, like appointing presidents in three European countries in the last 5 years and saying, this is our new model where we appoint presidents. That's like Hitler invading in World War II and appointing presidents and premiers, prime ministers. But it's like, it's okay. We took over. We've got fancy Hugo Boss black uniforms. So it's okay because we have machine guns and guys that'll kill you if you don't follow our orders. The average trendy just goes, so what if they're appointing presidents? Big deal. I'm a liberal. Shut up, homophobe. You're like, I have nothing against gay people. What if you, I'll even use the word you tell me to use. Shut up. You hate me. Or I'm not even gay, but you still hate black people. You're like, actually, I don't. It's like dealing with the idiocy. But let me tell you something. The big think tanks wouldn't have started all this anti-Russia stuff. There's Russian spies everywhere, and we've got to arrest Alex Jones and shut down the alt-media and shut down Breitbart and shut down Matt Drudge. The Russians, are they under here? Are they over there? I guess out of 50-something crew members, we do have one evil Russian who came over here to get away from the communists, and she's a little girl and then served in the U.S. military with an honorable discharge. But that doesn't matter because, I mean, Donald Trump's his godfather is Putin. I mean, we saw Rachel Maddow. She put my head up there with Trump's and Putin's like it was some type of, you know, communist ideology with the red in the background. Like we were the founding fathers of Marx and Engels when Russia is the one going away from communism. And when it's the Democrats that put out campaign posters not mocking people as founding Russian communist, but promoting it as founding Russian communist. I mean, there's no end to these people. So, let's finish up with this Hillary clip where she gets there, always by her plane, always at the airport with a four or five of her little minions that follow her around and roll oranges to her to ask her questions. Injecting, okay, it's an attack. Oh, it's a bombing now. Now we're allowed to say that. But only when the media says so. It's like yesterday, Owen Schroyer was in New York. He's back today. He and Zimmerman are sitting there talking to people on the street. You saw it on air. And he goes up to a TV camera person that's there at the scene and says, well, is Trump bad? And then this is an educated idiot he's talking to. He actually has an IQ, but is in such a cult that he has to say to you, okay, well, was this a bombing? Yes, it was a bombing. Well, Trump said it was, and everybody said he was bad. Well, that's because he jumped the gun. Well, no, there was, you know, two devices went off in one day, and he was talking to cops. It was bombs, and, you know, he's allowed to think on his own. If I see a blade of grass, and I say it's a blade of grass, do I have to wait for ABC News to say it's a blade of grass? And the guy goes, actually, I kind of get your point. Okay, I get it. That guy, you could tell, was smart. He didn't have dim eyes. But he was so brainwashed that he himself was there enforcing his own enslavement in front of us. And I don't call him an idiot because I get off on that. The person's an idiot to lie to himself, and those trendies care about what people say about him. So I'm going to tell you, if it hurts your feelings, not because I want to hurt you, because I want you to get up off your ass and wake up and break your conditioning. Brother, that's cult-level control, okay? When Trump can't say it's a bombing, and when he's proven right, that's a bad thing. That's upside down land. That's bizarro world. We ain't living there. So let's go to the clip. Here it is.
Are you concerned that this weekend's attacks or potential incidents in the coming weeks might be an attempt by ISIS or ISIS sympathizers or really any other group, maybe the Russians, to influence the presidential race in some way and presumably try to drive votes to Donald Trump, who is, as you've said before, widely seen as perhaps being somebody who they would be more willing to or see as an easier person to be against?
Well, Jennifer, I don't want to speculate, but here's what we know. And I think it's important for voters to hear this and weigh it in making their choices.
Back it up. See, now, 4 days in, we don't need to speculate. When the government doesn't want an answer to be there, even though the answer is right in your face, like 4 days after the sun rises and sets, ma'am, will the sun come up tomorrow? We don't want to speculate. But here's what we know. Oh, she's the authority, like grandma talking to a two-year-old. Here, let me talk to you like you're a moron. Oh, here, Hillary, I'm waiting for you. I'm not going to say you're standing in front of a jumbo jet saying Stronger Together. I'm not going to say it at a news conference. I don't know where Hillary is in this video unless she tells me. I don't know if this is a piece of paper from Politico saying George H.W. Bush to vote for Hillary Clinton. I mean, it says that, but I have to wait till they tell me, because I don't really exist. I just have to sit here as a spectator, as a computer program, and receive whatever they tell me. So, okay, I'm ready to receive it. Here's what we know, okay? See, no one else can speculate, but I can talk now. I am where the knowledge comes from, like Moses up on the mountain. This is the religion of arrogance, of these authoritarian, hunchback, crone-like demons that rule us. Here it is.
We know that a lot of the rhetoric we've heard from Donald Trump has been seized on by terrorists, in particular ISIS, because they are looking to make this a war against Islam.
Okay, back it up again. Because I could teach a college course on brainwashing and disinformation and this war on narrative bull I'm about to define. First, they won't call it bombs. They won't call it Islamic. They won't call it terror. The guy's dad said he went to training camps. He warned the police and the FBI. They were ordered to stand down because, you know, this stuff doesn't exist. Just, it isn't happening. Now, Trump's proven right. It's happening. And so these groups are seizing on Trump. That's why. Really, Trump wasn't running until a year and a half ago. And Al-Qaeda and ISIS invaded 20-something countries. And our own government was there funding them and protecting them. And the news was calling it the Arab Spring. This woman was running the State Department then as the lead general in the telecommunications, in the phones, in the communiques, in the WikiLeaks, in the admitted public data. She was the one ordering the stand down. She was the one not letting people get help in Benghazi. She was the one when Gaddafi, months before, was totally ready to surrender and give the West anything they wanted. He was going to run to France, he thought. And they set him up to kill him because they wanted to loot the country and make it a failed state to destabilize what was left of Africa. Think about that. Everything she says is the opposite of it. She is the leader, the founder, literally, of modern ISIS with Obama. What Trump said is pure truth. Told him by the former head of Defense Intelligence, General Flynn, who's a super patriot, who is preparing to try to save the country right now, meeting with foreign leaders 18 hours a day to try to stop World War III, that this lady and George Soros, the Messiah, go look it up. George Soros believes he's the Messiah. All he leaves is death and destruction behind him, but he's a Messiah. I'm going to try to shut up and just get to the clip after it, but here it is.
War against jihadists, violent terrorists, people who number in the maybe tens of thousands, not the tens of millions. They want to use that to recruit more fighters to their cause by turning it into a religious conflict. That's why I've been very clear. We're going after the bad guys and we're going to get them, but we're not going to go after an entire religion and give ISIS exactly what it's wanting in order for them.
Well, ISIS is panicking and now admits they're being beaten because finally our military working with the Russians is ignoring Obama's orders most of the time and taking them out. So now they've said stay in place. They launched a worldwide emergency on Sunday and said stay in place. Start killing where you're at. So that's now Donald Trump's fault because you launched them, Hillary. And then it gets worse. Donald Trump's son puts out a tweet of Skittles saying a whole bag of Skittles might be not poisonous, but two or three of them are poisonous with these Muslims. Would you let them in? Obviously not. I was watching Fox News this morning. They go, has Donald Trump Jr. gone too far? A bag of Skittles. So they take normal speech like people saying, yeah, Thomas Jefferson said in the Declaration of Independence, we have a right to fight back. Oh, my gosh, they're calling for violence. That should be outlawed. They're taking normal American speech and demonizing it now. They're taking normal Americana and saying, the alt-right doesn't have a right to exist. Let's continue with Hillary.
To enhance their positions. Secondly, we know that Donald Trump's comments have been used online for recruitment.
No, you and your husband have.
We've heard that.
Pause again and back it up 10 seconds. They're the ones working with the Europeans, working with the British and others and the French who allowed Islamic recruiting, Wahhabist recruiting, to launch the Arab Spring. Where Bilderberg met north of London, we went there and covered it. It was in the news that the year before they hatched the Arab Spring with Facebook and Twitter and Google, MI6 and NATO, and the State Department of the U.S., and launched it the next year. They've launched this whole takeover of 20-plus countries, hundreds of thousands dead per country in some cases, 60, 70,000 dead in Libya, bare minimum. And then she sits there saying Donald Trump did it. So now it's Islamic terror. She told you it wasn't a few days ago. So it's Donald Trump's fault. Let's continue.
We know that Donald Trump's comments have been used online for recruitment of terrorists.
That's a leftist model.
We've heard that.
That's why they're banning your speech in Germany and a bunch of other European countries and the UK, arresting people that mildly criticize Islam or radical Islam and say it's wrong. That's why they arrest you, because you are causing them to kill. Our governments bring them in, they start killing everybody, acting like total animals towards women. Then we're supposed to kiss their ass and adopt what they're doing because it's our fault. This is the script that Merkel and Hollande, and they all follow it. In the colleges everywhere, you're seeing a script thrown at you like you're an idiot. Continue with the whore, with the witch.
We know that Donald Trump's comments have been used online for recruitment of terrorists. We've heard that from former CIA director Michael Hayden, who made it a very clear point when he said Donald Trump is being used as a recruiting sergeant for the terrorists. We also know from the former head of our counterterrorism center, Matt Olson, that the kinds of rhetoric and language that Mr. Trump has used is giving aid and comfort to our adversaries.
Hayden and Olson are working with the globalists to illegally spy on the American people. That's all been exposed. They're part of the program, not letting the real data and intelligence get to the FBI and others. And I'm not defending the FBI, but it's had its hands tied. The intelligence flows down to the FBI. The FBI agents get prosecuted. The San Bernardino shooters, 2 years before the FBI tried to stop them, they were going to Pakistan, Saudi Arabia. Criminal charges investigation was opened on a civil rights violation by Loretta Lynch's predecessor, the Attorney General. And then now she's expanded it. These people are so sick, and you sit here and you watch them engage in it, it makes me want to throw up. And I apologize to prostitutes, ladies of the night, whores. That is a old profession, and I think honorable profession, compared to Hillary Clinton, and that just slipped out. It's like calling somebody a bastard. Big deal if you don't have a dad that stayed home compared to that. That's not that big an insult. A lot of great people are bastards. So it's wrong to call Clinton a bastard, you know, her husband. He's a rapist. He's a criminal. He's a thug that only gave 5%, it's now come out, of the money they got for Haiti to actual people in Haiti. They kept tens of millions of dollars. Those are monsters. Those are master criminals. Those are filth, the likes of which you've never seen. Witch. Evil, twisted witch king is a proper name for her. So I apologize for starting to call her a whore. I'm sure MSNBC will have fun with that. Give me a break. You people have hitched your wagon to a whore of Babylon, drunk on the blood of the saints, engineering the murder of Christians. Skip this break. It's too important. Ladies and gentlemen, it's literally out of the Bible. I'm not saying she is the whore of Babylon, literally, but the Bible says there are many antichrists, there are many whores, there are the antichrist spirit. And you study these people, there is a spirit that animates them, and everything she's done is they'll go out of their way to target Christians in Africa, Christians in the Middle East, Christians in Europe, Christians in Eastern Europe, Christians in Russia, Christians in Central Asia, Christians in Northern Asia, Southeast Asia, into the different areas in the Pacific. They go out of their way to target Christians. That's even admitted by mainstream news. The persecution and murder of Christians is logarithmically doubling every year because there is a bounty out. Millions of Christians are being killed a year now. The numbers are just untold. Untold! Because she, who launched this giant Arab Muslim Wahhabist spring, is a whore of Babylon, drunk on the blood of the saints. Look at her stumbling around. They're out of the Bible. Drunk. So demonic. So such a mass murderer. You think Jeffrey Dahmer was bad with 7 or 8 bodies in his refrigerator? Give me a break. And a deep freeze? This woman is just murder the Christians. Destroy everything. Just I mean, you notice drunk is, but still stumbling forward, more blood. As he falls down, they go, our God must be lifted back up. And more blood. Sell the baby parts. Arrest the reporters that expose we're keeping babies alive. Eat the hospitals with their bodies. Have the Pepsi taste testing systems be based on fetal tissue. All demonic systems. Genetically engineer all the crops. Overthrow creation. More blood. That's Hillary. Drunk on the blood of the saints. Just hit me. She's it's biblical. It's prophecy. Stumbling. Full of the blood of the innocents. Oh my God. Full of the blood of the saints. Full of the blood of the innocents. An actual goblin vampire. Black Belly would be her name. Filled with the blood. An intergalactic mosquito. Oh my God, it's incredible, it's all true. Now, let's go to the next piece. Talking about intergalactic mosquito, that's a metaphor. It's an allegory for the media. Look at this body snatcher. Politico, George H.W. Bush, we have this clip, to vote for Hillary Clinton. Oh my gosh, oh my gosh, all the old evil warmongers and those that called for world government and those that bankrupted our economy and those that reversed the Reagan policies that made us so successful. Oh my gosh, this horrible, I mean, this wonderful person has come out, this globalist minion of evil. This curse on humanity with this horrible family has now climbed back out of the pit to have one more utterance that, you know, your mother's doing you know what in hell as he spews figurative green pea soup out of his maw to tell us that he likes Hillary Clinton. Look at both of you prepared for the abyss. God's chefs are metaphorically, spiritually loading big, juicy apples into your mouths and the big furnace doors opening up. And you're sliding in on rails. I'm afraid the patriots are already prepared for you when your new world order arrives. See, you think you're the only people that know about these plans? And, oh, you've got all these plans, and they're so evil, and, oh, they're so demoniac, and there's so much energy in them. And, but there's a whole other level above that that sees your whole plan and knows how to stop it and knows that you have only been the people sent to prepare us to crush you in our elementary school graduation ceremony. So, George Herbert Walker Bush to vote for Hillary Clinton. They call themselves a family. You know, I've interviewed all the top CIA people, and I say all the ones that will talk, dozens and dozens. And it's all come out. The Clintons were recruited for the CIA when they were both in high school. And then they were put on section together. We have another section chief in London. They were sent into the Moscow to try to infiltrate the Russians. They were brought back here. They were then set up by different paramilitary groups and the CIA to run for the governorship, to bring in the cocaine, to do all the rest they've done. And that's why they've been vacationing with the Bushes. They had that whole fake election in 1992, 93. It's all staged. I said it was staged in 96 when I first got on the air. And now they admit they vacationed together and call themselves family because William Jefferson Clinton is the son of the former Rockefeller governor of Arkansas. Now, let's go ahead and go to a clip of the family, the Bush family, worshiping the Clintonistas.
You've often referred to Bill Clinton, and you talked about his relationship with your father and how it developed, and your mother as well, and he's your brother from another mother. What does that make Hillary Clinton to the Bush family?
My sister-in-law.
Interesting.
He thinks of George a little bit like the father he didn't have. And he's very loving to him. And I really appreciate that. I love Bill Clinton.
Yeah, it was the Rockefellers that set up Herbert Walker and Prescott, his daddy. And so they're returning the loving favor. When I say loving favor, I mean loving. I skipped two breaks this hour. Nobody does that in talk radio. I just get so fired up, I can't help it. We need funding. Quite frankly, I've not been plugging. We're not doing that good right now. We need to keep the reporters we've got and hire more. We have the very best products you're ever going to find out there on nutraceuticals, the supplements, the Hillary for Prison t-shirts, whether it's storable foods or books or films or non-GMO heirloom seeds, the way God made them. It'll be a conspiracy one day that there were ever seeds that were natural. I heard once trees had their own seeds and self-replicated. Oh, the bots have picked us up. You've committed a section 784-2X5 crime. Oh, I heard that women once had breasts and gave milk. Another crime you've committed. Anyways, I mean that's where we're going here. Where you ask Hillary 4 days later, was it a bomb, Hillary? We won't jump the gun now, my dearie. And the reporters, thank you. But continuing, herbs that God gave us, concentrated, 20% off super male, super female vitality. We need you to get this and try it just for your own self and see how amazing it is for stamina, libido. See the 5-star reviews from third-party sites we link to on InfoWarsLive.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And a ton of people went and downloaded the new InfoWars Live app that's got video feeds, audio feeds, alerts. So many new functions will be added in the next few months. Get the feed now. And most importantly, share it. It's a war. InfoWars.com/app. I like that term. InfoWars.com/app. InfoWars.com/app. And it's free from the NSA globalist at Google and the exterminist over at Apple to throw it in your face with the sign of the fall of man with an apple right in your face. Well, we're going to take that apple and shove it where the sun don't shine. We'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen, because there's knowledge above that, and we've got it to defeat this. Get the free app, jam it down their throats, send the link out, hurt them, hammer them, beat the brains out politically. The great object is to be beyond the reach of the petty, wannabe fallen god of this world. And for those of us that have seen the enemy's designs, I can't imagine ever being part of this kingdom. In fact, I'll be honest with you, I thank God every millisecond in my DNA that I do not resonate with these enemies, that I do not want their approval or their they are weak little grasping twisted pieces of trash that were chosen by this system because they were such pure objects of emptiness. Pure objects of emptiness. That's funny. That's a good one. But, okay, I'm being myself here. Can people handle it? Can you handle it, folks? Because I try to sit up here and be calm covering all this. And, you know, I read news about 2-3 hours in the morning, and I sit there and see the big rollout in the last week in thousands of publications saying, hey, listen, we're going to get you out of your cars. We're going to run your thermostat. We're going to control everything. And by the way, your kids don't belong to you. Oh, and by the way, we got 1,000 different vaccines coming online the next few years we're going to make you take. and there's nothing you can do about it. I'm just like, whoa! Feel like Ben Grimm on steroids. It's clobbering time. I mean, I can't help it. It's just this evil is announcing itself, running around, flapping its wings, crapping out failure behind it. It's about a foot tall, little red eyes. And if we collectively just woke up, we'd stomp that son of a piece of trash right back to Hades. Now, that's the worst part, is if you look at it, it's this little... I mean, look at Maddow and all these people. Look at Sink. And I mean, they're all just weak blobs of just empty filth. Perched on us, spewing their BS, how they're the intellectuals and they control the language. They know everything as they script what they say for 6, 7, 8, 10 hours before with little teleprompters and screens and have little lessons and things about how to look like they're credible for everybody. These empty nobodies. And then you got to watch them commit evil. That's the thing. Like, if I wanted to commit evil, boy, could I. But I don't want to. I love humanity. I want to lift it up. These people, it'd be okay if they were like super advanced and just saw humanity as ugly and bad. Then I could kind of maybe buy it. But we're not. We're beautiful and incredible. And then they're the worst of us, freaking out to get rid of us because they can't stand being in our presence. Well, I got a little bit of a news flash for you. if you want all of us to die to create this utopia, I think you should go first. Oh, I know you won't, because you're the guardians. You have to stay behind and run everything, because you deserve it, don't you? I've got a little newsflash. You will never inherit this earth, and you will never cross the River Jordan, and you will never go into the promised land. You can see all the technology, all the amazing things starting to happen, but with it, evil intensifies. That's because evil is running it. When evil is relegated to its rightful quadrant, you're going to see a jump in human development that is going to be unimaginable for those of us alive in this millisecond. And these controllers are pulling their hair out, knowing that the jump is about to be made, and are just, running around, overthrowing all the genetics of the planet, murdering, killing innocents, killing Christians, because they have the spirit that is the operating system to save the planet, while just allying with every failed evil they can. I'm here to tell you, victory is absolutely assured, but individually you have to take it in your hands. Coming to you in occupied Texas under FEMA Region 6. But our local police, our local governments are becoming aware of the occupation. They're becoming aware of Agenda 21, Agenda 2030. They're becoming aware of the fact that, yeah, this stuff sounds crazy, but truth and history is stranger than any fiction. They're learning they're going under UN control. They're learning that the founding fathers are being demonized. They're finding out that the patriots were right. And now it's time to try to stop the globalists from engineering a civil war. I have massive news, more news breaking, so much to cover, so many clips. But something I mentioned yesterday but didn't get to is very important, because it's bigger than just the story. Yeah, news is, you know, a 24-hour, really 6-7-hour cycle. But all of it can be a teaching experience for myself as well. I was thinking about something. There's kind of a riddle in a mystery. You've got Tim Kaine, the VP that was demonizing yours truly by name last week, implying that we want violence, totally made up. We don't want offensive violence. We will defend ourselves. We're not looking forward to that eventuality. We want to go down other roads, historically much more palatable for all. But if forced into said briar patch, let's just say in the scheme of the ages, those of you that serve the fallen system don't end up doing too well when the good people actually stand up. But I'll just stop right there for you. Now, continuing. Oh, you always do good up front, but not into the second and third act. Now, continuing, I was thinking about this. Trump comes out like he always does. And it was Matt Drudge that was here a year ago that again, laid out a battle plan that's been really almost prophecy, but it's not prophecy, because we understand the globalist program and he has the sources. But he said, we need to go with that refrain. Hey, if Hollywood's going to have guns, and if Obama's going to have guns, and if Hillary's going to have guns, you should turn your guns in. You shouldn't have Secret Service protecting you. And they never will address the logic of that. They always just say, what, you want them to get killed? You want someone to go after Hillary? Is that what you're saying? We go, no, you had to do mental gymnastics or mental twister to get to that. What did I say? The common people don't get to arm ourselves under your system. You'd like to disarm us. We can't afford it. You take what little money we have and have us pay to then have thousands of men and women protecting this person. But then we don't get the right that this country was founded on for an individual to protect ourselves. And they take that and they go, you want to hurt Hillary? But then I started thinking, you know, it's a false charge on the surface to say that that was a threat against Hillary and he was implying go after Hillary. Clearly, that's not what he meant. He was covering the point that everybody's made for decades and that Drudge has been pushing heavily that, hey, we don't have bodyguards. We don't have the money. I don't have the money for bodyguards. Sometimes I do. But the point is that I can't do it all the time. And quite frankly, the mission is so important. I've gotten to the point of saying I'm not just going to be filled with bravado and, you know, be so macho that I don't care if somebody comes after me, because quite frankly, I don't have time to be afraid. I don't want to steal a Ventura quote, you know, don't have time to bleed. I don't have time to be afraid. I'm not. I'm afraid of failure. But I need to have some protection to go as far as I can in this fight. Next thing, if I was a helicopter going into attack an enemy emplacement, if I could have armor on that helicopter, would I want it? Absolutely. I'm going to attack a machine gun and a rocket emplacement with my helicopter. I've got courage, but I want, if I can get it, an armored helicopter. If I'm in a war for my country and my family, and they're going to send me up there in a tinfoil helicopter, I'm going to do it. But the point I'm getting at here is, but I began to think, though, but see, that's from their position. They are telling us the truth in a way with a Freudian slip. They're saying, you want to hurt Hillary, saying take her security? We're saying, no, we're not allowed to have security under your system. Our own security, we pay for her, and then we can't have it? That's wrong. That's discriminatory. That's not what freedom is. Slaves are disarmed. And they come back and say, you're threatening her. We're calling the Secret Service. Trump wants to hurt Hillary. Did you hear? Coming up next segment. And then it hit me. What they're saying is actually true. It is an assault on Hillary Clinton to take her armed guards away and to say that she couldn't have a gun to protect herself. It really is an attempt to lay her open to be killed and attacked. It really is an attempted assassination on Hillary. Not the way Trump meant it, but the way they do it to us in Chicago and New York and D.C. and other places that have the highest crime rates in the country and the world, in Chicago's case, saying we can't have guns, the good people, is saying only the bad people can have guns and the ruling class, so they can hurt us and can dominate us. So it's true. Yes, Trump did threaten Hillary Clinton, and she's threatening all of us. So he threw it back at her and said, listen, witch, if you can be armed and protected, we can too. Got it? But see, they hope logic is dead in their vassals' little MSG fluoride brains. Now, I'm going to go start going with these clips. Here is Kane, Twisted Kane. Trump incited violence against Hillary Clinton with call to disarm her bodyguards. And I guess that's actually, in a way, true. Again, she's inciting violence, saying disarm us and have Chicago's even more dangerous, the worst places in Mexico. Chicago's the most dangerous city in the world. The United States has 5 of the top 10 safest cities. We also have the worst, run by filth like Hillary. So here's Kane unintentionally telling the truth.
Let's turn to politics, and I want to begin with Donald Trump's comment on Friday night about what he believes is Hillary Clinton's hypocrisy when it comes to the issue of gun control. Here he is.
I think that her bodyguards should drop all weapons. They should disarm. Right? Take their guns away. She doesn't want guns. Take their. Let's see what happens to her.
Senator, do you believe that Donald Trump in any way was inciting an act of violence against Clinton?
I do believe that, Chris. I was stunned when I saw it, although he's done it before. So two things. First, Hillary Clinton and I believe in the Second Amendment. We support the Second Amendment. We do support gun safety rules consistent with the Second Amendment. We're not taking people's guns away. But second, this notion that he's done before, look, if Hillary gets elected, then maybe Second Amendment people will have to take care of the situation, or his comment Friday night, or his statements in rallies, you know, I'd like to punch the guy in the face. He is using language that is an incitement to violence, or an encouragement of violence, or at least being kind of cavalier and reckless about violence. And that has no place in any election, especially an election to be president, commander in chief of this country.
But to ask specifically, because what you're saying is fairly stunning, you believe it's incitement to violence against his opponent in the presidential race, Hillary Clinton?
I do. So, use the other example. You put it in the context of other things he has said. If Hillary gets elected, we may need Second Amendment people to take care of this. What did that mean when he said that just 3 weeks ago? And when you look at a series of these comments that he's making, I do believe it is an incitement, or at a minimum, an expression of indifference to whether violence
would occur. That's good. I want to play the responses of Pence and Christie, but let's be clear. I could take the Bible and cut out each word of it and write a whole new book that was 1,000 pages long or whatever. So he says, you say you take other things he said and put it with that. Well, no, he was being clear with, again, pure Americana. If we lose the Second Amendment in the courts, the Declaration of Independence, Bill of Rights, says it's our right to take it back with the Second Amendment. He gave a mild version of what Heston said. My cold, dead hands, they're acting like that's wrong, that's evil. But the dishonesty is to mix it all together and then to claim that that's what he was saying earlier. No, he's saying, if you want to take our guns, you give up your protection, lady. It's very simple. A three-year-old should be able to understand it. If I've got to give up my toy gun, you've got to give up your toy gun. You know, a three-year-old would get that. An adult would get, if I've got to give up my real gun, you've got to give up your real gun. Just like Ice-T said many years ago. He said, I'll give up my guns as soon as the government gives theirs up. As soon as Hillary gets rid of her bodyguards. He actually talked about the Clintons. He said, as soon as the politicians get rid of their stuff, I will. You don't, was Ice-T threatening you? No, he said, I'm just as good as you, lady, okay? So let's go to Pence, the VP candidate, about to be VP, responds to Kane, absolute nonsense. Here it is.
On Friday night, Mr. Trump said something else that's gotten a lot of attention. He said the Secret Service protecting Hillary Clinton should disarm. And then he said, let's see what happens to her.
Nope, let's hit pause. Let's hit pause. I'm going to skip the break. I got to respond to this. Ladies and gentlemen, here's the total deception. She cut off the part before in his statement, which they always do, where he said, if they want to take our guns, if they want to restrict our right to defend ourselves, then let her disarm and get rid of her bodyguards. That's clear. Just like, it's really hard to get into America legally right now. A lot of good people want to come here. We need workers, folks. I hire a lot of great people. We need to make it easier if you don't have a criminal record, you're not a felon, not a rapist, to come here to the country. I'm going to do that. And if you're illegal, you just go right back out. You prove it, come back in. But if you're a felon, a rapist, a murderer, a shooter, there's a lot of bad people coming in, a lot of bad folks. Mexico's got big problems. Their criminals are coming up here. Then we're going to deport you. There are a lot of bad Mexicans. We're going to deport all of you. That's how they edit. Just like they've been doing all week. Oh, yeah, the bombs that went off. Yeah, Trump's bad for saying bombs. Cut off the first part about bombs. Bill Clinton, oh, she falls down all the time. Cut it out. She hardly ever falls down. So let's start the clip back over, because separate from just what Pence is responding, there's lessons everywhere about their deception. This is ABC This Week engaged in prostitute-level behavior. Here it is.
He said the Secret Service protecting Hillary Clinton should disarm. And then he said, let's see what happens to her. What did he mean by that?
Well, I think, you know, Donald Trump believes in the safety and security of every American, and any suggestion otherwise regarding Secretary Clinton is just nonsense. I mean, the point that he was making is that Hillary Clinton has had private security now in her life for the last 30 years, but she would deny the right of law-abiding citizens to have a firearm in their home to protect their own families. I think what Donald Trump was saying is if Hillary Clinton didn't have all that security, she'd probably be a whole lot more supportive of the Second Amendment.
But exactly. Let's see what happens to her. Whether he intended that or not, the message sounds a lot like a threat or encouraging.
Hit pause. I'm so sick of, back it up 5 seconds, these chicken neck fake liberals all, because they teach them to like have fake emotion like a psychopath would do. But what did he mean? And I told you this a month ago, I told you this 2 weeks ago, and now I'm seeing the talking points. They're getting everybody ready for a staged assassination attempt on that reanimated corpse, Hillary. Folks, we don't want anything to happen to Hillary. Everybody knows it. They've already claimed in a bunch of newspaper articles, AOL, Associated Press, MSNBC, that I want her to be hurt. No, I'm not a vindictive person, but she's very evil. She's killed a lot of Christians, a lot of innocent people. I kind of like watching her twist in the wind up here, kind of like she's in the stocks or those cages they'd hang you on at London Gates, you know, where you just sat there till you were a skeleton. I don't want anybody to physically do that to her, but she's doing it to herself, running as an arrogant corpse with the Chinese and the Saudi Arabians and others behind her. You know, with this flock of rotting crone media, dinosaur zombie media, just scabbering like a pack of zombies to defend their witch king. So, no, we don't want any harm on Hillary, but I'm telling you, false flags the next, how many days of election? 49? 48 days! Boom, 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 boom. I mean, this is history. You can just, the energy level is just, I can't even handle it right now. I'm so alive. And you notice everything they do turns to total crap right now because they're under judgment. But if we don't stand up politically and spiritually and culturally and economically against them, we're going to go into judgment. We're getting, because of the incredible providence America had, our incredible ancestors, we're getting passes nobody gets. But I'm telling you, if Trump gets in and we don't make a real effort to turn things around, to actually try to really stop cultural Marxism and race baiting and divide and conquer and crime and corruption, if we don't repent and really get right and really pay down the debt and really kick these foreign banks out and really make a major turn, we're going to be destroyed within 4 years. I predict it now. I'm telling you, God's giving us four. I just feel it. I know it. I've been thinking about this. I've been waking up all the night about it. I never had problems sleeping. I've been waking up constantly. I can't even sleep now, folks. I even quit drinking coffee in the afternoon. I even quit taking, you know, Brain Force in the afternoon. I don't need it. I have too much energy now because of what's happening historically. And I'm here to tell you, Trump gets in. He's got to start delivering. We've got to back him because there's going to be problems. There's going to be failures. They're going to plunge the economy. They're already planning it. They've already got it set up to plunge it, whether she wins or he wins. It's all set up globally. That's admitted now. It's happening. We have to grow up, be adults, realize the attack we're under. I go back to Russia. Russia's economy finally, after 14, 15 years, was doing good after the fall of communism. Whether it was a fake fall or a real fall, people embrace it. It was getting a lot better. I saw the metrics. Then they've been under sanctions 5 years. It's gotten really bad again. The Russians, though, have gotten more patriotic and know what's happening. Just like the UK going under Brexit, they're now going to try to bankrupt them as well with economic warfare. The bankers are. The people have to identify it. They have to pull out of it further. They have to disregard the EU just like Iceland did, or you'll go to the route of Greece. But you want to fight. You want to be free, folks. You don't want to be in bondage with the TV. I saw a TV ad this morning on Fox. Almost every ad I see, I saw a FedEx ad that was anti-hunting, where they're sending this clown mask or Groucho Marx mask to New Zealand, and then they go to these right-wing hick idiots that are hunting deer, but the deer are wearing the mask so they don't get killed by the evil hunters. It's just everything's propaganda. And it's not that hunting's God. It's that that's normal human behavior, like farming or ranching or gardening or sowing or barter or doing electrical work or doing machine work. I was talking to Jesse James about this like 6 months ago. He's been demonized. He's not the guy they say he is in the media. And I was talking to, he's a good friend, and I was talking to a bunch of Tim Kennedy and others. We were just all talking about, we've got to get men back to being metallurgists, and women too. We've got to get back to making our own things. It's like it clicks things on in your body. And the more manly somebody is, the more traveled they are, the more they've done things, they realize that everything clicks on like a light switch when you go in the woods. When you take a swim in the river, when you hike up the mountain, when you plant the vegetables, when you harvest them, when you cook them, when you stand up to a tyrant, when you do the right thing, when you care about people, when you're not a cool person. I'm not a cool person. I don't act cool. I'm not waiting to have the right answer and act like I'm slick. I'm hot. I'm on fire. I'm unscripted. I'm alive. And my only fear is the enemy has their way with us. And I love how Pence just goes, that's ridiculous. He's saying, how would she act if she didn't have bodyguards? And the snake goes, yeah, but she realizes she's losing. So if you were a TV viewer, you could see it. She just, yeah, well, how about this? Yeah. Their whole system's about the weak and the twisted ruling the righteous. Let's go back to her.
Whether he intended that or not, the message sounds a lot like a threat or encouraging violence.
That's absolute nonsense. His comment was that if she didn't have all that security, she'd change her attitude about the right to keep and bear arms. And I'll bet that's probably true.
And then she goes on to go, yeah. Now, let's go to the next clip. This is Chris Christie, who I've got problems with, but he is smart. He is a great speaker. He can make great points when he wants to. My problem is he flip-flops a lot, and I pray Donald Trump isn't a big Chris Christie. Because let me tell you, I lay awake at night hoping I've done the right thing, and I know I have. I know he's for real. I know the enemy's upset about him, but still, we're the ones that are going to back Trump so he doesn't get pushed into a corner and have to start compromising. But the stronger we get, the stronger Trump gets. You understand that? Trump is a figurehead, like we're a Roman legion, like an eagle. You understand that? Let's continue with the next clip.
You just heard Senator Kaine say Trump was inciting an act of violence against Hillary Clinton. Your reaction, sir?
Man, I tell you something, boy, when a race gets tight, even a guy like Tim Kaine gets desperate. I mean, to imply, I mean, before you can imply, he said that that was to incite violence is outrageous, and he owes Donald Trump an apology. Donald Trump was trying to make a point about Hillary Clinton wanting to have one set of rules for herself and a different set of rules for the American people. And that's what his point is on the Second Amendment. But Senator Kaine should be ashamed of himself for saying that Donald Trump would like to have violence perpetrated against Hillary Clinton. It's an outrageous statement, but just shows how desperate and scared the Clinton-Kaine campaign is now, because this race is now a dead heat and they can't believe it. And they're going to get even worse news as we move forward here, because Donald's going to continue to do even better.
That's right. And that's the big question I want to ask listeners when we come back after break. 800-259-9231. This is a specific question I want you to call in on. If you're not calling on this, please don't call. 800-259-9231. I want to ask callers, what are they going to pull next? Because she's 10, 15 points ahead in non-battleground states that are Republican, maybe 20 in some. He's like 5, 7, 8, 10, 12 points ahead in battlegrounds. I mean, all I do is study this, okay? And he's set to win some Democrat states. Watch, watch, watch. The landslide will be so massive that they won't be able to cover it up, and he's going to win Democrat states. Folks, I told you a month and a half ago when it was, he's done, he's plunging, it's over. I said, people, he was 15 points ahead in many polls, 10 points ahead in the others. This is total made-up crap. And people figured it out, and Hillary collapsed, and all this other stuff happened. It's providence. But going out to break, I'm going to come back and take your calls on the subject, 800-259-9231. I'm not going to have her answer, which is pure bull. I already played it last hour. But here is Bloomberg asking her about Trump with the Russians behind the attack. Here it is.
Are you concerned that this weekend's attacks or potential incidents in the coming weeks might be an attempt by ISIS or ISIS sympathizers or really any other group, maybe the Russians, to influence the presidential race in
Russians.
Some way?
All right, that's enough.
Try to drive.
And there's a full article and the full video is up on Infowars.com. And she goes on to say, oh, yeah, it might be the Russians, you know, or, oh, Trump's inciting ISIS and Al-Qaeda to launch this terror attack. I thought it wasn't a terror attack. I thought it wasn't a bombing. Now this guy's father admits, Ahmed Khan Rahimi's father told police in 2014 his son was a terrorist. They did nothing. And people blame the FBI. They were ordered. They can't even investigate Muslims. That's official. I've had the whistleblowers from Homeland Security on. We'll be back. Stay with us. There has been a metaphysical law that all cultures, going back to the beginning of the first clay tablets that were carved, the first hieroglyphics and other human languages, from the beginning of language, I mean, our first writings, humans have had a metaphysical rule that for every action there's an opposite and equal reaction, and that when evil rises, good rises to meet it. And so there's this paradox. The more evil they hit us with, almost like pesticides on bugs, the stronger the poison, the faster the bugs become immune to it. And actually, in many cases, you know, mutate to even be stronger. And the globalists understand this rule, but they don't seem to understand that in the paradox, from my own study, just observing it, those that are evil and that are openly directing it, the blowback is even stronger than what they hit us with. The Bible says, you know, the pit they've dug for us, they will fall into. But it's happening. And so that's why they claim that they manage crises and create chaos to rule it, because the truth is they can't create anything. They just wreck stuff and then declare that they're the authors of it. Very important to understand the New World Order's mindset. Now, let's get into the news here. First off, I guess it is our best-selling prof. It's not our bestseller. Our bestseller is Survival Shield, nascent iodine X2, but that's so inexpensive, we don't really make any money to fund the operation. Our most profitable product is Supermel Vitality, because we actually, you know, make like 20-something bucks on it, which is absolutely needed to fund this operation. But it's still unheard of to put that much money into a product, cold-pressed herbs, where they don't get dry herbs, make them wet, and then cold-press them. We get the fresh herbs, more than 20 of them, that are known to increase stamina, libido, you name it. And then it's cold-pressed. And then it's basically fermented for a short period of time. It just gets better over time. Group told me this like 5 years ago when we started doing this, and I learned it was actually totally true. And I was amazed, because I've got some of the first batches from Mel Vitality. It just gets stronger. And it just concentrates. It's concentrated basically essential oil from plants. And not even plants that are normally seen as oil-bearing plants. I mean, I call it oil because it's so thick. And it's got a unique flavor to it, because, I mean, it's the real deal. And I've talked a lot about this. I didn't start taking it for libido. I don't really have a problem in that department. But let me tell you something. I'm 42, about to be 43. But a few years ago, I finally went for a 40th checkup. My mom's like, you got to go to the doctor. You haven't been to the doctor in decades. You know, for a checkup, will you please go to the doctor? And I said, okay, I'll go to the doctor. And we're actually out at the lake with the kids at a picnic, and she watched me swim across the lake 1 mile and back, and told me to get out, and I was somewhat overweight. She said, son, I don't get how you're not losing weight, and you're working out and all this. You just swam 2 miles. You know, she was a UT master swimmer herself, won gold medals nationally. A little bit Olympic if she got into it. She didn't get into it. She was like 35, but I digress. I was a good swimmer too. And she watched me swim, and she said, you need to go to the doctor. So I go to the doctor, have my blood tested, all this other stuff. Overall, I'm pretty darn healthy. My blood was, told the story a lot, so I should shut up, but borderline diabetic. Not borderline diabetic, but getting into the borderline where it would soon be borderline. It was going in the wrong direction. And I went to the doctor, had all my blood tested. You know, like after that, by another doctor, I looked into it all. I started taking vitamin B12 injections. But really, the big game changer, I don't even take those anymore, was when I started taking Supermel Vitality every day. And I work out less now than I did 3-4 years ago, and I'm still going to be some beach boy, but with my shirt off and wearing shorts, folks can see that I'm in pretty darn good shape compared to what I was just 3-4 years ago. We can show for TV viewers the video. We also have the video posted on InfoWarsLife.com by the Supermel Vitality, where you can see that I've lost 70 pounds of fat. Yes, folks, I weighed 180 pounds, was running 6 miles almost every day, lifting weights. When I started InfoWars 21 years ago, and then I quit working out in a couple of years and gained almost 100 pounds. Well, I've gained 70 pounds of fat, gained like 30 pounds of muscle, and I am a new person today. And I'm telling you, I'm actually ashamed of it. I was just saying, I work out. So I started trying to lose weight like 6 years ago, and I lost like 20, 30 pounds. Took some supplements, it helped, but I was jogging, I was swimming, I was lifting. It was ridiculous. And now, taking the iodine, taking the Supermel Vitality, taking the DNA Force and stuff, it's spoiling me, where I'm in really good shape, especially, you know, like I said, when I'm wearing shorts, I look like a gorilla. I mean, you know, I'm not Mr. Skinny, but I mean, I got a six-pack started forming before Cleveland. I gained like 10 pounds back when I didn't work out for a few weeks, but I've almost lost all that again. The six-pack is reforming, and it's just like, my God, I look like a gorilla. And I'm working out like 3 days a week instead of 5 days a week, killing myself. I mean, I did some five-mile swims, and I would get out of the water all red and be like 3-4 pounds lighter, but would come back the next day. So whatever happened in my metabolic systems, I don't know. But Supermel Vitality, 20% off, InfoWarsLife.com, changed my life. And I'll be honest with you, a little more anger, some temper issues. I mean, this isn't a game. This is a real product, folks. So consult your healthcare provider before you take it. The biggest thing everybody knows is well, like I said, the same medical doctor said, hey, you're 40. You want some Cialis? You want some Viagra? You want to try it? And I said, sure, I'll take a prescription. I mean, I never went to doctors. I didn't know they were just, you know, giving prescriptions. Cialis, a little bit of an effect. Viagra just made me, like I said, like kind of be dizzy and like kind of see blue. And I was like, people take this stuff? So I'm not bashing Viagra and Cialis. I don't need it. super male vitality, 10 times the effect of Cialis is what I experienced personally. I mean, I don't even really, quite frankly, need it. In fact, quite frankly, a lot of days I don't take it now because I don't want to feel like I'm about to, you know, climb a mountain or tear somebody's head off. But that's what God offers us with plants from the rainforest and things versus what the establishment's pushing. I'm done. I didn't mean to do an 8-minute, you know, or 5, 6, 7-minute plug. But I started thinking about it. I'm like, wow, this really did change my life. And I was just telling Pat Riley, who I work out with a couple days a week, and I'm developing some products with him because he's a developer himself. I was like, man, I ought to work out like I did 4 years ago, 5 years ago. I'd be in incredible shape. This stuff has made me lazy. It really has. Because I'm looking at myself in this photo. I'm like, how do I look like that when I was working out 3 times harder 5 years ago? Because it's what was going on inside my body, period. All right, I'm done talking about it. It is your purchase that supports the broadcast. We also have a new free app. We haven't had a new app in 5, 6 years. We only had one app before that. It's free. It's a great little audio app. It has a news feed on it. But this is for droids. It's for Apples. You go to Infowars.com/app to find links to the Apple Store and the Google Play. It is free, as in F-R-E-E, and it's made to spread the word. Listen, I'm going to explain this, and I'm going to get back to these clips and then your phone calls. They've done everything they can to keep us off TV, everything they can to keep us off radio. It doesn't matter how many radio stations I've been on where I get better ratings than the top-rated shows. We all know who that is, Rush Limbaugh. I'm not against Limbaugh. It's just a fact. I've beat him in more than 12 cities I know of with huge, I mean, like 5,000-watt stations beating 50,000 waters within a year. And then proverbially, like clockwork, a sports channel comes and pays 3-4 times what it's even worth to kick me off and put me on. In fact, the joke began in the industry is you put Alex Jones on for 6 months or for a year. There's a little secret to the two affiliates out there. A lot of them have learned it. And then when those people drop off, they bring us back. They apologize. I talk to the affiliate. It's totally fine. I don't, you know, I'm not going to get you in trouble. You can try. It's not illegal what you're doing. I get it. You put me on, you get top ratings. They want to get me off the air. And, you know, a hospital district comes in and finances some talk show host, you know, or the feds come in and finance a talk show host, or, you know, ESPN's normally the one 9 times out of 10 that takes me off the air. And they come in and then they kick Alex Jones off and every other libertarian and conservative there is. So the point is if you want to fight stuff like this, spread the word while we're on these stations, obviously. But understand, this app isn't just for you to see the video feed or the audio feeds or the podcast links or the updates and the news alerts and all the stuff we're going to add, videos I do daily that are live and archived only for you on the app. That's coming in a few months. We've already got it set up, but I'm setting the studio up at my house, you name it. I'm hiring people to follow me around and show up at night and show up like clockwork, you know, at 6 a.m. I'm going to get up out of bed and like reality TV. I mean, you're going to have me getting out of bed, folks. You're going to have me just fighting the globals from the moment I wake up. I'm going to jump out, underwear, whole nine yards, go and get in the shower, come out of the shower, rah, you're going to be eating eggs, whole nine yards. I mean, it's coming down, okay? That's what you want, you get it, okay? Pure warfare, everything I'm doing, what's happening, total transparency. It's the InfoWars Live app. It's free, but what you need to do is send the link, Infowars.com/app, to your email list, to Twitter, to Facebook, and say, here's Alex Jones's new app. Test it out. If you like it, tell folks about it and explain that this is how you break the mainstream media with choice, with free will. Everything the globalists do is about shutting down your free will, shutting down free market, shutting down this economy of ideas. The Clintons back in the early 90s. It's come out in, you know, lawsuits in their Clinton Library Foundation, a separate foundation from the Global Initiative or their other Clinton Foundation, their first foundation. They said, we can't allow a free and independent press in this country. Not just for right-wingers, but leftists as well. Here's how we're going to do it. We've got to attack their funding, not let them ever have sponsors, not let them sell books or videos, not let them get a foothold. Or if they do, it's over for us. Call them conspiracy theorists. And then the CIA is in there advising them on how to do this. We have you now. And we have patriots inside the system watching you who are aware of what's happening, who are going to continue to sabotage you because you're the foreign occupiers like the Nazis occupying France. You're done. It's over. Figure it out sooner than later. We'll let you go to the island of Alba, metaphysically. We'll let you leave. We'll let you go. We don't want to corner you. We don't want to stomp on a rat. We want the rat to get out of our Sunday dinner. Just go. Don't go away mad. Leave us. Phantom Zone. Go be with yourself. But I know you're going to have to be routed and dug out of your holes. You always are. And people will say, this is who we were fighting? You'll be put on display. This is Revelation says. But I digress, ladies and gentlemen. What I'm getting at here is that it's a big thing. You are the power. I don't sit here and say you're the power. You're the resistance to make you feel big and important because, you know, other talk show hosts don't do that because they're such arrogant. You know, thank me when you call and I have all the answers. I'm explaining we all have the historical answers. Common sense, common law, understanding that there's natural law, rediscovering that, and then everything makes sense. And then sharing a link to a story, a video, a free app, retweeting it, Infowars.com/app. It's called Infowars Live. There's a lot of other free apps out there. Others people made, great, whatever. I just don't want to get in the customer service calls constantly. I mean, every few minutes for our crew for years about other people's apps. This is an app. It works great. We're updating it. We're tweaking it. We're going to be adding a lot of things. Infowars.com/app. Or simply sign up for our free newsletter. We can send you videos and exclusive articles every day and special deals, sometimes 50% off on different products every day, big coupons for InfoWarsStore.com. For folks that sign up at InfoWars.com/newsletter, we'll also send out the links there. We've got links, again, at InfoWars.com/app, InfoWars.com/show. But whatever you do, realize that that's not talk. You are the entire body of this thing. You're not just the blood or the guts or the brain or the eyes or the muscles or the sinew or the joints or the will. You are the spirit. You are the energy that animates the whole thing. Look at Hillary. Her spirit is gone. She has no spirit. My spirit. It'd be 60 degrees in a room now. I'm sweating. I can be at home at night, sitting in a cold room, thinking, writing notes, and sweat starts dripping down my head. I'm so alive. My body is so heated up to resist this assault on our species that just historically, DNA at a gut spiritual level, I can't even handle it. The species, all my ancestors, everything is saying, here, you want the answers? Boom, take them. This is like, ah. And that's what they're trying to keep people from entering into. And the rites of passage in ancient rituals, and I mean rituals, having a child, rituals, standing up to a bully, rituals, planting food, rituals, cutting firewood, rituals, staring at the stars, rituals, honoring your father and your mother, rituals, being good, being honorable. It transcends the enemy. It raises our spirit. It's unstoppable. I got loaded phone lines, and I've got so many clips to get to. I've got to go to. Let me tell you, I leave it all in the field here. History's happening right now, and you know it is. And if I'm one thing, know this, I'm genuine, ladies and gentlemen. What you're seeing is real. I believe the things I'm saying. I know the things I'm saying. I noticed the enemy my whole life on air, more than half my life on air now. I've been more than half my life on air, has always been that I'm a fake and I'm not genuine. Because the enemy is fake, and they cannot stand the fact that I am genuine. And quite frankly, I'm ashamed of some of the things I'm genuine in. But all I got to do is point my heart at God and everything else happens. And that's all you've got to do. And you already know that. I'm not telling you things you don't already know. But the enemy all day tells you things to countermand reality. So you feel like you're alone. So you don't follow your spirit that God gave you. I can't skip every break today. I've got to play this break for the networker, though. I might just end up doing a show 3 hours a day with no ads. I'm really thinking about it, just doing my own show and breaking off. I've been doing this 19 years here, but I've told them to take it serious. It's like, because I'm just like the stalwart guy that's always there, always loyal, always, you know, like, the thing is, next hour, I will, after I take this group of calls, I'll get to the next round of clips that are very, very important. I went long on that plug. It wasn't really a plug. It was mainly a rant. With this war on narratives, again, they create these fake things like transgender bathrooms. I'm not against transgender. The point is they create it to become the, you know, what's your gross national product? Oh, it's trannies. It just becomes some weird grand falloon. That was a term that a great patriot wrote about, where people just make up these weird things to celebrate and to be their own little crazy club. Kurt Vonnegut, who the left will be horrified to hear was a big listener. But he was ashamed of his mind before he died. I didn't think he'd do a good job on air, so he wouldn't come on. What a bummer, man. I'm going to get Clint Eastwood on, not because I care he's a Hollywood star, because I really like him. Before he, you know, dies, it's just like, oh, I'm old, I'm not going to come on, you know. Still flying around your own helicopter. We're going to come back, but then coming up, I'm going to get into this whole war on narratives. What does it really mean? Stay with us. Nico Acosta, our head producer, said, hey, this is a great show today. Yesterday, you were just torpedoes in every direction, rampaging like Godzilla through downtown Tokyo. Today, you're more focused like a laser beam. I don't know about that, but I get down sometimes just looking at the lies. I mean, Donald Trump is bad because he said it's a bombing. And then Hillary's saying it's a bombing. And then the media today is like, he's been discredited. He said bombing before it was admitted. It's like, he won the World Series. He's just Babe Ruth discredited as a baseball player. You know, Michael Jordan's discredited as a basketball player because he made all the hoops. I want to go to Angelo in Georgia and Dwayne in Canada and Uncle Sam in Louisiana and Michael in Washington and the Canadian soldier in Canada. If you just tuned in, what is Hillary and the globalists, who we have their internal emails from everywhere, RNC, DNC, Chinese Communists, White House, Bohemian Grove, they legitimately hate Donald Trump. They legitimately are running the country, robbing it. They see him as coming in to stop the destruction of America. This could happen. We could defeat them. Doesn't mean we'll be in some heaven, but at least folks aren't out to get us and make us poor, because that makes us controllable. We have a managed monopoly economy with a bunch of criminals running it. They're scared of going to jail if Trump gets in. They're a rat who's cornered because they know they've committed crimes. What are they going to do? Angelo in Georgia, thanks for calling.
Hey, yeah, so I know my time's limited here, but the first thing that I can almost guarantee you they'll do undoubtedly will be to double down. Whatever they're doing, they'll double down on it. They'll try to make it look like they're right and everyone else is wrong, and they'll keep going until it runs them into a brick wall. The other thing I'm pretty much certain, having dealt with a lot of this mindset over the last couple of years, it's been a little bit rampant, will be that they'll try to push it as the norm for, it seems that Trump's words and ideals to be those of what they keep trying to say is hatred. They'll try to push that to be the norm. You can see a lot of that in a lot of international things right now. I think it was someone in Germany said that it was in a recent magazine that they were asking about the U.S. presidential election. And I think it was in Sweden, wasn't it, that they had the recent commercial about the immigrants, and it's everyone.
A government-funded commercial saying it's bad to be Swedish. You need to accept Islam and wear a burqa, and this is the new, this is the new Sweden.
Right, right. So it looks like to me the next big hit, if I'm no expert, but if you were to take my word on it, it looks like the next big hit will be an international movement to try to discredit Trump.
Well, that's, you know, it's funny you say that, because Mono. Of you too, Bono has come out, total fake leftist, caught making you download his songs and charging you on iTunes, Spotify, you name it. Every time I open up a Spotify, it's this guy forcing me to listen to his music. He's a guy that keeps 98.8% of the money he gets from charity for Africans, you name it. That's his favorite. Oh, he loves black people. Meanwhile, it's come out Hillary only gives 5% of the money she gets for charity. This monster says that Trump is potentially the worst idea that ever happened to America. Can you imagine if Trump ran huge charities and put on concerts and then was paid billions of dollars and kept 98.8%? Hillary gives just 5.7% of foundation budget actually went to charitable grants. I mean, this is insane. She makes 91 million plus and then gives 5 million. But it's okay, because she's a woman. It's like she can commit axe murders and it's okay because she's a woman. So, yes, the international attack is intensifying. They're talking about a worldwide financial meltdown the next month. That's the inside scoop. What do you think?
I think that's where they're trying to push it towards. I don't know if they'll be able to complete it in time, but they're definitely moving towards it. But there's another flank they're going to try to attack on, which they're already working on. I believe Joseph Watson has an AMA later, actually, on one of the sources. The internet flank.
Hold on, I'm coming back to you. You're a great caller. I just saw the video. It's breaking. New Obama video. from him in the past. It's up on Infowars.com. Stay with us. We're back in 70 seconds.
Visit GCNI.
Oh, my gosh. Angelo, I'm coming back to you. One of my younger daughters said, George Strait's rich. He doesn't have a dime, but what he's got is his. He's singing a song about a rodeoer back in the 1980s before he was rich. But see, no matter how much money you have, what is rich is what you stand for and what you believe in and what you do, as Martin Luther King said. It isn't about what color your skin is. It's about what you do and what you stand for and the content of your soul. Think about how morally bankrupt the left is worldwide to be pushing racism and division. Now, that doesn't mean the other opposition parties are any better in many cases. It just means, my God, they are going for broke. I mean, this is quite a spectacle. Our guest didn't join us at 30 after. We're going to get to all your calls and a bunch of other clips. The big news is up on Infowars.com. Exclusive leaked video shows Obama. This is exclusive. By the way, we've got exclusives that are so big, I don't even know how to deal with them. And I'm just going to say one word, because the government already hacked into a bunch of stuff that's coming after us for us. Not the government, criminals. One word, WikiLeaks. One word this week. One composite word, InfoWars. And I normally got folks follow me around routinely. They got a lot of folks following me around right now. So. But it doesn't matter. I'm just one venue, and it's so big, I'm trying to process it all and trying to make sure I don't hurt anybody that's out in the field. That's your big problem when you get this kind of stuff. So we got that in the hopper. I'm going to just stop right there. But in the hopper, we got this too. I'm deeply saddened that whites are superior, close quote. Well, you mean whites were living like savages killing each other just 1,000 years ago but started getting out of it? I mean, humans can have IQs and kill each other and not have civilization. What about the statement that whites are superior? I don't agree with that. Never before seen video set to be released soon shows President Barack Obama railing against white people during a 1990s trip to Kenya. His family is exposing him. Get ready for those torpedoes to drop real soon. Oh, I'm afraid we're going to fight back. But right now, Angelo, great points on how you think they're going to counterstrike. Make no mistake, it's already happening. How else do you see the establishment that admits in every globalist publication of repute, of renown, that they're going to launch everything to save Hillary, the final domino to fall, or their world government is dead on arrival? Angelo, anything else?
Am I here?
Hmm?
Am I on?
Hmm?
Oh, wonderful. The next thing that I'm pretty sure we'll have a hit on, as I mentioned, as I was going to a second ago, is Trump has a huge online presence. I'm fairly certain, based on a lot of recent events, including one of the sources that Paul's having his AMA on later, that source has been getting hit really hard, as you know, from Reddit. There's a lot of Twitter sources that are dissenting against any right kind of conservative opinion. I have a feeling that that's not done yet.
I totally agree. Massive censorship. We're about to see them really use the first stages of internet kill switches Drudge predicted 1 year ago. And absolutely, you're on target. Man, what a great caller. You want to host a show for us, Angelo?
Oh, love to.
Thinks they got the metal to host a show, shoot an hour-long YouTube, free flow talk, send it to Show Tips, and we're ready to hire people. I'm going to spend all our remaining reserves in the attack. I'm all in. I'm not even worried about infiltration anymore. God's got to cover me. And that's just, I trust in God, but top my camels. Better one say, but at this point, I'm all in. I'm not watching my six. I'm engaging the enemy. Jeffrey in California asks, what's the next shoe to drop? He just called in, so I'm going to go to him in a moment. Let's go to folks who have been holding. Joanne in Canada, Uncle Sam in Louisiana, Michael in Washington, Canadian soldier in Canada, and others. I'm going to bam, bam, bam through your calls. We just had an amazing caller call in. If you joined us. Talking about internet censorship, massive manipulation. Look, if they're on TV claiming the Russians have taken over the election, so Homeland Security and the EU and the UN are going to run our elections, I mean, we are in cockamamie, cuckoo bird, crazy town right now. It's going to get a lot crazier before it's all over. But before I run out the clock here, let's go to some phone calls here. Canadian soldier in Canada, you're on the air.
Hey, how you doing, Alex?
Good, brother. God bless you for calling. Go ahead.
God bless you, your crew, and may Christ protect you as well. I got 2 points, if that's okay.
Please, sir.
One is your products. I use 10 of your products, but 5 regularly, and it's a game changer for me. I use DNA Force, Anthroplex, Brain Force, Superman Vitality, and Nascent Iodine. And let me tell you, for years since I got crippled in 2008, I was barely able to walk, do anything. I tried all the high end products like Hydroxycut, Xenadrine, or whatever, and they just didn't do it. As soon as I started yours, now I'm walking 15 kilometers of crutches.
Wow.
I tape up and I'm able to do fire team assaults on the range. Just so you know, your products are real.
Wow.
And I'm not saying that to blow sunshine up your butt. But
well, did you hear me earlier? I was working out a lot harder than I am now 5 years ago and wasn't losing weight.
Exactly. I mean, I'm still working out the same, but the progress is just amazing.
Well, thank you. Listen, I set out to go find the top developers in the country that are patriots and say, what are the ultimate products at an affordable price that still funds our operation? And it's such a satanic society that most of the nutraceutical makers will put, you know, $5 a product in a bottle and sell it for $50, or $2 and sell it for $30. We'll put, you know, $20 in something and sell it for $39. That's still 100% markup. We got to fund the operation. We need more funds, quite frankly. But I just can't get, you know, the average industry is 5 to 7 times markup. I mean, it's a joke. I will not do that. But I mean, I'm being honest with folks. With our quote business model is how we want to be treated. I'm very honest about it. In fact, I feel guilty if I don't just tell everybody what I'm doing and how I think about it, because I'm always trying to really be the best person I can, because I understand that I want to be treated like I want to be treated. I treat people like I want to be treated. But thank you for the plug, for the products. They've changed my life. And now that I religiously take them every day, because I've never been a pill guy. I knew our biggest sponsors were nutraceuticals. I knew they helped people. I knew supplements were big. And I said, but sponsors aren't getting it funded to expand. Why don't I just put it out, make a bigger profit, make sure the quality's great. And people say, well, wait a minute, if they've got bigger markups, how is it a bigger profit? Well, now I cut the middleman out. That's how we do that, to be able to expand. And so it all really turned out great. But I had no idea. I thought supplements just helped you. I didn't know it changed my life. But sorry, go ahead.
Those supplements I bought from GNC didn't work. Let me tell you something. Yours, I'm able to do a 2-man fire team alone. Assault.
Wow.
From 100 meters on, like running, without crutches.
Wow.
And I'm missing a lung as well. And like your lung cleanse, it helps.
Well, I'll be honest. I don't like to defend Hillary. I don't like to defend Hillary, because we know from the Secret Service she's falling down and really sick. I mean, she really is sick. The mold, because all this rain, really is bad. I mean, I cough a lot. I get a cough like that sometimes. And right here, I've been doing this 3 or 4 times a day to not hack on air, lung cleanse. And all it is essential oils. But anyway, I'm going to stop plugging. The point is, absolutely, sir. Go ahead.
No, I mean, your lung cleanse helps me because I only got one lung. I lost a lung in 2013.
Wow.
But anyhow, like I said, the whole point I was trying to make is, last time I talked to you was false flags blamed on Russia. Right?
Yes, sir.
And look what happened. They bombed a Syrian position, right?
Yes,
and then they say they did it by mistake. Russia knows what they're doing.
For folks that don't know, because our media is not covering it, 80-plus Syrian soldiers were killed in a key ISIS al-Nusra offensive. And the Russian generals, we have a clip of it, actually, I'll play it in a moment since you brought it up, coming out and saying, look, the U.S. is violating the ceasefire. They mean Obama. Our military is working with the Russians. That's on record. The Russians know that, by the way. And you are helping ISIS advance. Go ahead. And I remember you called a while back. You did predict that.
Yeah. Like, I remember I told you in 1999 we disobeyed an order to start World War III with Russia.
I remember. You were there in Pristina, there in southern Kosovo.
Pristina Airport.
Yeah, they're in the middle of Kosovo, southern Serbia.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you know, this is when the Antonovs are still coming in, taking equipment out before it was handed over to NATO. Right, because they had Heinz and HIP helicopters. And I told you about the 2 BTR-80s blocking the road.
Yes.
Yeah, anyhow. Ever since there's classified piece of equipment, I'm going to tell you the name of it. I shot down the F-117 Nighthawk, the 2S6 Tunguska. Ever since that happened, And I saw the Clintons in Sofia in November. They look down on people like they're scum. I was there at their rally.
Now, I remember, supposedly the Serbs shot down a stealth fighter. Was it really the Russians?
The 2S6 shot it down. The Tunguska.
What is that weapon? Tell us about the Tunguska.
It's got 8 air defense missiles and 4 30-millimeter cannons, 2 per side. And it's on a tank chassis. It can spoof its radar signature to an older system. So when the HARM missile comes, it goes to the wrong target. Meanwhile, it takes out what it wants. That was classified. I just let it out because, you know what? They're blaming Russia for everything. People may as well know the truth what happened. They tested it. It worked. That's why they wanted us to start a war with Russia, because Russia was weak at the time. And now they're trying to push the Russian narrative again.
Yeah, what do you make of Hillary agreeing that Russia might be behind the bombing while covering up for the Islamists?
Russia is going to be pulled into it. Ever since, Clinton hates Putin. Why? Clinton's the globalist. She's a sellout.
He's a Christian and a nationalist.
And Putin is the only one that's left of the free world. And we did right, regardless of disobeying orders or not, at the airport. Because the world would be different if you
were. Well, they admit, General Jackson, after you guys refused, did the right thing and said no, even though others in the U.S. were ordering that attack that would have started a war with Russia. Because the word is the Russians were ready to respond.
Yes, they were. They were pointing their weapons at us as we did them. I mean, for 45 seconds, we were pointing weapons at each other. And then as soon as it was over, the Vulture Press asked, what happened? And all we asked was, you know, who won the hockey game last night?
So insane to blame an Islamic State attack, which is taking credit in New York and New Jersey, on Russia, and to Hillary to go along with it. I mean, to have Bloomberg blaming Russia, this is a new level of BS.
I warned you that this is going to happen. They're going to blame Russia.
No, you called about 2 weeks ago and said, get ready for a false flag to blame terror attacks on Russia. And I didn't roll my eyes. I just thought, I think I said, that's a stretch, Canadian soldier, but it happened.
I told you. When Clinton has a grudge, they keep it.
I've experienced her grudges. I know what you're talking about.
Scout, I'm alert, so I have to know my enemy to defeat my enemy.
Well, great point. Canadian soldier, if you want to give us your number, I'd love to get you on as a guest officially. I don't want to get you in trouble and stuff, but you're really a great caller. So give us your info if you want. If not, God bless you. And by the way, did we get your address a few weeks ago and send you that product? I want to send you some of the product.
And my brother Joe, or brothers.
We'll put him on hold. Make sure that happens, John Harmon. Thank you. Gosh, it's hard to cut off callers like that. We got so many. It's really amazing. Actually, see, I trust but verify. I actually remember it was guessed that the Russians had a artillery-fired missile. Most artillery now is missiles. Most artillery now is guided. The shell goes out and little fins come out. And somebody was showing me some classified footage of one of those 20 miles shooting around through a window. They've got like even medium-sized field guns now that are basically missile launchers. But imagine the Russians have got them that'll... perfect how they use modern radar. The Russians just went back to old radar. In fact, I'd read that separate from the list from the caller. They went back to old radar, and then basically, I'm not an engineer, but they flux it. They send out a bunch of different radar scrambled, and then somehow, doesn't matter the way that signature is done for modern radar. Well, who wouldn't have thought the Russians would just go back to old radar? See? And that's what happens in wars. No matter how sophisticated the globalists are, whatever they come up with is going to be countermanded as soon as we figure out we're in a war. That's why they never want us to know we're in a war. The Muslims aren't attacking. They love you. They love you. I'm going to skip this break to go to more calls. Let's go to Jeffrey in California, then we'll go to Dwayne, Uncle Sam, Michael, and others. Thank you, Canadian soldier. Jeffrey, you're on the air.
Thank you for taking my call, Alex. I'm honored to be on here. I know you're honored to be on here, too. One thing I want to say before I make my point on what Hillary's going to do here, which we already know, we can just go to a website and see there, she's redoing her little tax system thing. And, you know, it's like almost she's listening, or somebody's listening to the Trump speech in North Carolina, and automatically you could see how she's going to reform the immigration system and and how they're going to keep the homeland safe, you know.
Yeah, that's right. She's acting more like a nationalist now on the surface. It's totally fake. She's like, I don't want your guns. That's ridiculous.
Right. And the more she lies, the more the lies come out, the more I see the people around me here in Southern California, especially the Latino males, 18 to 40, I see them. They're coming around. They're talking to me more. I'm not.
By the way, national polls show that Hispanic males, Latino males are flipping, and people are saying it's because they don't want to be bossed around by Hillary. Because they're playing it like it's sexist. No, Hillary clearly is dangerous. Is going to kill prosperity. And the average man, I don't care what color you are, deep down knows Hillary is out to get us. Okay, she doesn't like men, and she doesn't want to empower women either. She wants a big, stagnant North Korea she rules over.
And I'll tell you what I see is it's not just the macho thing. It's also, too, the family thing. And that's what Trump needs to hammer in on, that, because this whole DCFS or CPS or whatever they call it in whatever part of the world you're in, you know, this comes from, it takes a village. It's her whole agenda. So Janet Reno and all of those witches, they got together and they say, well, this is how we're going to indoctrinate your children. Well, it's in Southern California, the Latino families or the Hispanic, whatever term you like to use.
Sure, but I don't want to kiss the ass of Hispanics in general, but on average, Hispanics, okay, where they come from, or the U.S. or Latin America, wherever, take vaccines the less, don't trust the government, don't pay the taxes, they know it's all fraud anyways, and know what's going on, and don't tattle on their families. The CPS, on average, individuals may not be bad, but it's admitted a eugenics program by Clinton is when they put these quotas in. There's a lot of good social workers that help old folks, you name it. They took a good thing and turned it into a deal where they'll take kids from a good family, but then meanwhile, if a kid is like in a crib, never having his diapers changed, they'll leave it with the bad people because there's an adoption racket going on in many cases. It's not in every area, to basically take healthy kids and adopt them out for $500,000. That's where the real racket is. And so absolutely, I've always pointed out when I've covered these cases, people try to take Hispanic families' kids, they just leave. You know, they don't sit there and have their kid taken. I'm like, there's common sense and a life force. You know, and again, it's a complex system with the courts. Some courts are good, some are bad. Our families are collapsing. Society's in crisis. It's just like, I don't want to blame the TSA. I blame ourselves and Congress for letting this happen. But they still, it's a big joke. Our borders are open. They're bringing in the Muslims, the radicals. But we search everybody, you know, at the TSA. It's all about training us. But you're absolutely right. And that's what all the polls show. Listen, they freaked out in Nevada and other states when they did polls of the voters. It was like four or five states. And we're talking out of like six, seven, eight, nine candidates, depending on who was in at the time. Trump was getting 35 to 60% of the votes in a field of a whole bunch of people by Hispanic males. And then they did demographic studies with Hispanic males across the board, and they've got the numbers out in Politico today. It's huge. Listen, we've got numbers of 20% of black males set to vote for Trump, 16% of black females. Black females vote 95% in almost every election of the Democratic Party since the 1960s. So this is huge. I mean, people are really... But listen, if Trump becomes the same old plantation that the Republicans and Democrats have been, it's a disaster, and I will turn against him. But if we just try and do some good and reverse a little bit and have some prosperity, which we can do, it'll turn the tide. It's an amazing time. But Trump has to continue to rout the Republican establishment. Because let me tell you, they are the slimiest, filthiest people, just like the Democrats. They get off on... that they know how stuff works and you don't. We're here to show the hat trick, Jeffrey. We're here to show everybody how it really works. Because I respect everybody. I respect people that they should know how stuff works. I don't want to hold knowledge back and screw somebody over. I'm not somebody that sits there when a little kid walks by and I kick their legs out from under them. I want to see everybody grow and be their full potential. But I don't want people organized into groups to suppress my potential. So that's a two-way street. Go ahead.
The neocon system, that the two-party paradigm, he comes out of that. That's why he gets so much support in this part of the world. And when he came out here and I looked him in his eyes, the man's telling the truth. He wants to leave a legacy. It's a good thing that he's getting old because he wants to leave.
Well, I'll just say this. The private conversations I've had with Trump are unbelievable. So I'm going to leave it at that. But unbelievable how knowledge he is. I wish Trump knows they've done the population down. He's brought the knowledge level up some, but he's right. They twist what he says if he gets sophisticated. But the real Donald Trump is a genius. And the fact that he has played possum for decades against the globalists, that's why they're panicking. They know he's way smarter than them, and he doesn't have an instinct to screw little people. But that's why they're panicking. They're like, the little people are our food, Trump. He's like, no, they're not. They're our future. You suck. Get out of the way. Because the truth is, Trump is blue collar at the end of the day. Sorry, go ahead.
I want to let you know, Alex, when you did the Jade Helm thing and you saw how we got a little slither down here in Southern California of resistance, and you said that we're some kind of a drug lord from Mexico or something. That's not true. You came here just like Trump. We looked you in the eye. We're holding it down out here. And I'm not saying that, you know, we're going to start some kind of war or something, but let me tell you, buddy, we're rock and roll ready to go. And the number one thing we're doing, we're out at the polls and we're making sure everything's going on.
Absolutely. Well, I want to be clear. When I was looking at Jade Held map of like, why do they say Texas and Utah is Southern California? I was just saying, why are they saying martial law for that area in a drill when Southern, I said maybe a drug war or something. I wasn't saying it's a bunch of drug dealers in Southern California. It's everybody. I mean, it's one of the most populous areas of the country. It's literally everybody. It's the full spectrum. Thank you for the call, Jeffrey. Great points. What I was getting at is Jade Helm said they're training for martial law in America. I've talked to the special forces people who were involved. They said, no, it's really, Alex, flip the map sideways. It's the Middle East. And California is basically Syria. But and I was like, oh, my God. And they go, yeah, it's a joint training exercise. I was like, back of the head. But then, no, but you're right that it's dual training to condition the public and us for domestic operations. And we were training to take over local governmental buildings and things like that. But don't think we don't know. In the briefing, Special Forces was told, this is all martial law training, and we know it, so screw them. But I was never saying the military was going to take over in July. So I said back to the other people, like four or five meetings with different people, I said, well, you're kind of buying propaganda because Joe Biggs and I never said it was going to be martial law. We were simply saying it's training. They go, oh, you're absolutely right. It's true. So, again, we all just deal with the distortions. And not that all of us have the answers either. It's just that 9 times out of 10, when I deal with an attack, it's not what I said. They edit video, people. You just heard ABC News, if you tuned in last hour, going, Donald Trump said, let's take this protection away from Hillary and see what happens. Sounds like he wanted to have her killed. He said, the American people don't have bodyguards. We can't afford all this taxpayer-paid protection. So if she wants to take our guns and our protection away, let her take her guns away and see what happens. But that's what they do constantly. And once you're aware of it and take the time to go see the full clip, go find the full clip of what Trump said and then see if you disagree with it. And I'm going to say this right now. I watched Snowden 2 hours long. The whole thing was super accurate. I can't believe they got that movie out. I'm really proud of Oliver Stone, who I've been critical of sometimes in the past. Very impressive, okay? And Scott Eastwood and all of it. I mean, it's amazing. It's a tour de force. But the one deceptive part was acting like he became a liberal. No, he was always a libertarian. He never supported Bush. He just didn't support the Democrats either. And the other big thing is, if you see the movie Snowden, it, you know, it kind of implies like American patriots think they're doing all this to protect America. No, they're globalists that are using it to hijack the country. And so that's the rest of the story with a movie like Snowden. But I don't sit here and toot our horn. I sit here and I mean reality-based to tell people, I told you with NSA whistleblowers, Wayne Madsen, James Bamford, and a bunch of others, 19 years ago, 18 years ago, 17 years ago, and I had no idea what I was involved in. I had no idea that I was having people, after I had them on, bringing me the blueprints of how your TVs and radios watch you. Even radios have like chips in them that basically pick up waves and then they create pictures. It's very complex stuff. I mean, there's a lot of high tech that was invented that could be used to take us to the stars. that instead is being used to totally control everything we do. And I go see a movie like Snowden, and it's just like, because I already knew all this, but it was just crazy to see it on the screen. But did I get any credibility for being right first, long before Snowden or anybody else? You know, having the Army and FBI show up at Access TV. And it's surreal when you're in the parking lot and there's Army officers in plain clothes threatening you, you know, saying, are you planning terrorism because you just had a whistleblower on? You know, it's like a whole other world. People just don't understand it. All right, we're lining up former head of the Trump campaign, Roger Stone, right now. And your calls are coming up. I'll go in the fourth hour if need be. We got in the fourth hour today. Paul Watson. I don't want to cut into him, but we'll see. I don't like to cut into anybody, but it's got to be done sometimes. That is how the cow ate the cabbage. We got like 4 or 5 of these clips. This is really a big issue. They keep confusing the public, saying Al-Qaeda doesn't exist. It's now ISIS. Al-Qaeda means the base. ISIS means Islamic State or the base to start the caliphate. It's the same Wahhabist groups out of Saudi Arabia funding different jihad organizations who are Sunni Wahhabists worldwide. Like you got Baptists and Catholics. Well, you got Shiites and you got Sunnis. And in the Sunni group, it's 80% of Islam. You've got these super radicals that are running the show now. You can debate whether Islam's always been horrible or always been whatever or good. The point is, right now, it's run by folks who want to cut women's genitals off, burn whole cities, kill every Christian, Jew, atheist they get their hands on. And I got all the atheists and agnostics running around attacking Christians, worshiping Islam like it's cute and sweet. So I've got like 5 clips I want to play. If I don't get to all these before Stone gets on, we'll play them tomorrow. But Obama's global war on narratives, Washington Free Beacon. The narrative, like, it's wrong. There's a narrative that Islam attacks and is violent. Everybody knows the Russians bombed New York on Saturday. So here's that clip.
When it comes to ISIL, we are in a fight, a narrative fight with them, a narrative battle. In some ways, this is actually just a war of narratives. And so we want to make sure that we're getting out our counter narrative against ISIL. We also can't give them the narrative victory. We can't allow that kind of narrative victory to be given to them.
Tools like countering this narrative, because that is a falsehood that embraces the terrorist narrative.
That feeds the ISIL narrative. The terrorist narrative.
It also would feed the narrative that ISIL wants to feed.
Because these types of incidents play right into ISIL's overall narrative.
ISIL is trying to advance a narrative. To suggest otherwise only advances the narrative of ISIL. Only serves to advance the narrative that ISIL is seeking.
Right, pause. I don't hear any more of this. Okay, just stop it. It goes on for a while. So they're saying if you admit there's this Islamic attack takeover that the West is actually funding, that it's a narrative, and if you admit they're attacking, you're aiding the enemy. So the globalists are funding an enemy, they're attacking you, and so if you admit you're being attacked, you're aiding them. That's called upside-down world. That's called Alice in Wonderland Tea Party. So what is this narrative they claim is being advanced?
Face of the man on this screen. The name. He's a naturalized citizen here. He is from Afghanistan. It raises the specter of the fear, the xenophobia of those who are getting into this country and whether they are efficiently vetted in a way that has to be done. We know, but can it be done well enough? This is a big, big issue in this campaign. Is this a reflection of not getting it done?
Well, Chris, I don't want to speak to any individual suspects or individuals who are wanted right now. What I can tell you is that we are, when it comes to ISIL, we are in a fight, a narrative fight with them, a narrative battle. And what ISIL wants to do is they want to project that they are an organization that is representing Islam in a fight and a war against the West and a war against the United States. That is a bankrupt, false narrative. It's a mythology. And we have made progress in debunking that mythology. ISIL was a group that was viewed as on the move and on the march when they made a bunch of progress in Iraq a couple of summers ago. But since
I don't want to hear the rest of it. That's Josh Earnest, the former head White House press secretary, still out there shilling. But the Russian Ministry of Defense, in this official video that we're going to narrate live here on air, came out yesterday and said the bombing over the weekend that killed 80 regular Syrian military people was part of our government aiding ISIS and al-Nusra in a new offensive, which they're winning. So every time they start losing, our jets magically go bomb them. And we've had our own fighter bombers go public to Congress 2 years ago and say, we're ordered to blow up people fighting al-Qaeda and ISIS. I mean, our military's pissed. So let's be clear. Our military is not part of this. They are lied to. They are given fake targets. General Flynn is meeting with the non-radical countries right now. They are pissed, okay? Egypt is pissed. Syria is pissed. Israel is freaking out. I mean, who would think our government would openly ally with the most radical forms of Islam? So, you know, he talks about a narrative. This is the reality. Here's what's happening. Here is the Russian lieutenant general. Here it is.
It must be noted that the ceasefire was not achieved during this time. Within the past 24 hours, the number of attacks by the armed groups reached 53. Since the announcement of the cessation of hostilities, it has been violated by the opposition 302 times. During this time, 63 civilians were killed and 252 were wounded, while the losses of the Syrian armed forces reached 153. The United States and the groups of the so-called moderate opposition controlled by them did not fulfill any of the commitments undertaken in the framework of the Geneva agreements. But the main point is that the break of the moderate opposition from the Jabhat al-Nusra has not taken place. Moreover, what we see is not a break, but the merging of the moderate opposition groups with the Jabhat al-Nusra, as well as their preparation for a joint offensive. The reason for the created situation is that the United States do not have an effective leverage over the moderate opposition and do not know the real situation of the ground. One example of this is the strikes which were carried out 2 days ago by the aviation of the coalition against the Syrian troops near the city of Deir ez-Zor and the attacks by the ISIS militants that ensued. Considering that the conditions of the cessation of hostilities have not been met by the militants, we deem that one-sided fulfillment of it by the Syrian government forces are meaningless.
In the Twilight Zone world we now live in, a Nazi war criminal commands the United States, George Soros. He's definitely the leader, with all the weird Rockefeller money behind him. And he writes in newspapers that he believes he's a messiah. Just Google it. You can see it. A crazy person, almost 90 years old, who believes he's a messiah, wears a diaper, has a little wimp kid that runs around drunk on TV, bombed out of his brain, who is the new heir, I guess the new messiah, the mini-me. And our own military has refused Obama's orders for 4 years and now gives them fake targets that our military's told Congress were ordered to bomb the Syrian military that didn't start this. Our own government started it. The globalists started it. And then the Russians have to sit up there. And what's crazy is if the Russians do something wrong, I'll expose it. Like that. I don't care. I've been to Russia. They don't. They just say the truth constantly. It's like 100% true. And I just sit here in this Twilight Zone world where our government's overrun, working with Saudi Arabia, bringing in brainwashed hordes, 80% military-aged men, to every major city, waiting for the order to murder and burn and kill, and they won't follow the orders to stand down, so a small percentage go around and kill people, exposing the agenda they've got planned. The fact that these radical Muslims won't ever follow orders is one of our greatest advantages. They're so badly disciplined. It's like 3 years ago, they draw a red line. They say, if you cross this, we're going to attack you on the anniversary. Chemical attacks happened in Syria, and the Al-Qaeda, they were about to change their name to ISIS to confuse the American public, were proud of themselves. They shot videos of them going, Allah Akbar, blah, 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 and launching huge Saudi-made, James Weapons Quarterly admitted it, the UN had to admit it, UN certified Saudi Arabian chemical mortars, big, huge warheads, into cities to blame Assad. Hey, dumbasses, if you're going to blame Assad for it, don't send a video out to brag to your cousins and family, because the Saudis sends you a bunch of money when you do a suicide bombing or a nerve gas attack on an outdoor market. Imagine the Syrians are out there, their wives have their faces open, their wives can get PhDs, their wives can drive cars, you know, they got hotels coming in, Europeans are flocking to Syria, to go to the beach. They say it's one of the best beaches in the world for scuba diving and everything. The Syrians are coming into the West. They're investing their money. They're like, okay, we're going to have an election. Assad's all set up, trained in England, just like Gaddafi was set up, but a lot better than Gaddafi, and they blow the whole country up. I mean, think about that. And then they bring in hundreds of thousands of crazy, weirdo jihadists to sit around in their Western-funded madrasas talking about the women they're going to rape, the people they're going to kill, and they take over Syrian homes with gardens and swimming pools. Middle class is wealthy, was wealthy. And they come to a father. This has been on the news, and they say, we're going to kill your three daughters, your two sons, and your wife right now if you don't drive this truck full of explosives up to that army checkpoint and kill everybody. And in most cases, the father would just go ahead and go, okay, and drive it in and blow up his own countrymen because he had no choice. But in many cases, they would stop and say, I have bombs that my family's back there. Please send police, and they're going to kill my family if I don't do this, but I can't do it. And they would kill their families. Obviously, the military could never go into the occupied town and save them. So in hundreds of admitted cases, fathers would sit there and break down crying and say, they've got my daughters and sons, and they will just kill them, rape them, and kill them. And that's who Hillary Clinton supports. You guys tell me you have another clip. Which clip is that? Absolutely, the next clip. You're reminding me. This is Fox host to White House. People with shrapnel on their shoulders don't think this is a narrative battle. Yeah, the hundreds of thousands of dead Christians, hundreds of thousands of dead Muslims, almost all of them killed by the West and Hillary. She came, she saw, they died. It's starting this war. They don't think it's a narrative of names because the former White House spokesman says it's all about that because he believes Karl Rove's BS that just because you're some candy ass from Harvard with white shoes, you control reality. How about when Josh Earnest gets a big ass lung cancer or something? Yeah, just announce it ain't cancer, big boy. That's the good news about people like you. Reality's going to slam you right up against a wall. Hell, I know I'm going to be slammed against it. When I hit the wall, I'm expecting it. But little pieces of filth like you never expected it, did you? Let's go to this.
You mentioned earlier today that you believe it's a narrative battle that we're fighting. I think that for people who, you know, have shrapnel in their shoulders this morning, they might have a hard time accepting that it's a narrative battle that we're fighting against ISIS. Explain what you meant by that.
Well, I meant to, very specifically, Martha, that we are taking the fight to them on the ground in Iraq and in Syria. And the president is organizing a national coalition more than 5,000 airstrikes that we've taken against ISIL targets in Iraq and in Syria over the last couple of years.
Josh Earnest is dishonored.
But what's important in the context of the political debate is to remember that ISIL is trying to assert a narrative that they represent the religion of Islam in a war against the West and in a war against the United States. That is a mythology. That is a falsehood. That is not true. That is a bankrupt ideology that they are trying to wrap in the cloak of Islam. And to suggest that somehow we should treat Muslims differently or suspect them as terrorists just because of their religion is something that we shouldn't do. Well, we certainly have heard that kind of inflammatory rhetoric from Republicans.
We're not talking about that here because that's clearly not what's happening.
But this is the context in which I was asked the question about the ISIL narrative earlier today. And it is important that we don't play into that narrative. And that is what too many Republicans have been willing to do.
All right.
All right, let's discredit this little turd right now. First off, Hillary's saying it isn't a bombing, isn't a terror attack. Let these people in and is protecting them. And we just heard the Russians saying our government is protecting and airstriking the Syrian military so ISIS takes over. So you're totally discredited, and you let ISIS take over. You stood down for 2 years while they did it on purpose, and you've been caught. And you'll never change that narrative. And I can tell you, the Council on Foreign Relations and others are panicking that they've lost on this narrative. And they thought changing the name from Al-Qaeda to ISIS would change that. It hasn't done it. Let's go to Roger in Arizona. Roger, thanks for holding your own here worldwide.
Alex, thank you. I really like your show. Long time listener, first time caller.
Thank you, brother.
So, so looking at the overall plan for what I think is coming so they can steal the election, what they're going to pull. If you look at their playbook and you look at current events, I've got kind of basically 2 points. One thing is what's in plain sight, no one seems to talk about. I mean, yeah, there's memes online, but there's no mainstream coverage, which is really Hillary can't fill a high school gym. And even the people are there, half of it's media, half of it's just
Yeah, she has to show up to, like, town fairs, rodeos, city events to come to a crowd. She can't get more than 100 people, literally. The average is about 70. She's a total joke.
Yeah, and so Trump's got, you know, 10,000, 20,000 people at a time. But here's the thing. MSNBC recently, and along with a lot of other mainstream media, has been caught rigging these polls, you know, to make it look like it's close. And so the real question is why? Why are they trying to continue to keep her close when everyone knows she's a total fraud? And the answer is what they're going to pull within the next 7 weeks. I think proactively, if people hit the mainstream and just continue to hit the narrative, why is no one showing up? Why is no one showing up? How are these polls rigged?
It's funny you say that. I've laid awake at night thinking, how do we expose Hillary? And I think the fact that no one's showing up at her events, that she's the ghost candidate, is the way to go.
Exactly. So if you expose it that way, quickly, the polls start to melt. Here's the thing that's scary. You've got the guy from Princeton, this professor, who recently says, hang on your seats because something's coming. He Judge linked to a report in Hollywood as all the celebrities were freaking out that Hillary was, you know, getting her butt kicked.
No, that's right. In fact, the headline is Hollywood panics, begs. Well, he told you that they're meeting 2 weeks ago about getting rid of her. I mean, look, the Secret Service told us, they said, look, she's falling down more than once an hour. We don't know, but it's getting worse. And notice it all happened like we said. I mean, the Secret Service, the real Secret Service told us that. I mean, that really happened.
So the head, one of the heads of the networks there sat there and said, don't worry, she's going to win. I can't tell you what's coming, but she's going to win. So they know, the people who are in the know seem to know something. So here's what I think is going to happen. I believe what they're going to do is, and I, you know, I hope to God I'm a tinfoil hat crazy, but if you look at what they've been up to and the way they've laid this out, it makes perfect sense. You got to keep your eye on Lindsey Graham. If you remember a year or two ago, he was Mr. Nuclear ISIS is going to go nuclear.
Yeah, no, we exposed the fact that there was missing nukes in West Texas, and you notice they never denied it. We had that from the base. I mean, we had it directly from people that were. Anyways, the point is that, yeah, and then the next day they go, missing nukes. They're going to blow up, you know, the harbor on the East Coast. Yeah.
So here's how it could play out. Graham was the Bilderberger this year. That wasn't a coincidence.
They're going to say there's missing nukes. How are the two candidates going to handle it?
Yep, but it goes further. The Turkey thing, they made sure mainstream media said that Turkey's now in bed with Russia. So when something happens here in the United States, they're going to say it was a nuclear device that ISIS got from Russia. They're working with the Islamics, blah, 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 blah. And all of a sudden we need somebody.
No, I agree with you. Listen, I don't know if that's going to happen. It may. Anything can happen. I mean, hell, they're on Bloomberg and ABC News saying the Russians bombed New York and New Jersey, folks. I mean, they could literally show you a Photoshop video of me, like, raping reindeer with Santa Claus. I mean, there's no telling. This is a huge time to be alive. Briefly, we have the new InfoWars Live app at InfoWars.com/APP. Or go to your app store at Apple or the Google Play Store. It's free. It's InfoWars Live. Video feeds, news alerts, articles, very high-tech app, more functions coming to it very, very soon. But the most important thing is share that link. Share the app so that not just millions of you get it, but millions of others get it. That's how we circumvent mainstream media. Getting someone to click on an app and to be tuned into a whole TV, radio network, and news center is revolutionary. This is the info war. This is what's happening. Also, it ends today. 20% off Super Male and Super Female Vitality ends today. Amazing concentrated cold press herbs. InfoWarsLife.com. It is your purchases that make the broadcast possible. InfoWarsLife.com or InfoWarsStore.com or call toll free 888-253-3139. Now, Paul Watson's coming up for the whole next hour. I'm going to co-host like 20 minutes with him with Roger Stone, who got stuck in traffic as the big UN meeting, the bombings in New York, terror attacks. He'll be with us as well. Watson will be co-hosting coming up at the 5 after or so. And more of your calls coming up for those that are patiently holding from around the world. Roger Stone, great to have you. Wow. Hillary, I don't know if you've seen this, told ABC News and others, she's worried the Russians bombed New York and New Jersey Saturday. This after she came out and said it wasn't a bombing, even though she called it a bombing. It seems to be some of the most unintentional comedy ever.
I'm sorry, we just lost audio, so you're going to have to stick with us for a moment.
Oh, it's all right. It's always part of the fun of the show.
Yeah, he sure is. All right, there we go.
Roger, what do you make of Hillary not saying this was terrorism, now saying it's terrorism, but saying it may be Russia? I mean, this is, like, ridiculous.
Yeah, the Russian thing is an absurdity, almost as absurd as the notion of the Russians hacking our election, which Obama's CIA director has said. Alex, first of all, the traffic in New York is so horrific because of the UN, it's yet another reason to get the UN out of the U.S. I had to get out of my cab and hoof it 15 blocks. But it is, and in the aftermath of the terror attack, the terror bombing in the Chelsea area, this entire city is on lockdown. Now, Hillary kind of has refused to admit that Islamic terrorism exists at all. Trump got out there immediately with a forthright statement saying a lot more than I told you so, but essentially saying this is going to continue unless America recognizes the problem and gets tough. And I think Hillary saw the strong response that got, then she's now trying to sound like Donald Trump. It's not the first time, by the way, that she has attempted to sound like Trump.
You said last week it's Trump's to lose. He is the winner. How is the witch Hillary going to strike back?
Well, first of all, it's important, as former President Nixon coached me many times, to look at presidential elections within the context of the Electoral College rather than looking at a national poll. And Democrats and left-leaning journals like Politico have said for some time that the Democrats have an Electoral College lock. But with polls now showing Trump pulling ahead in Florida, Ohio, Nevada, Iowa, we have broken that lock, in my opinion, and we are in a situation where there are multiple possibilities under which Trump can win. He could could, for example, carry Pennsylvania or Ohio. Either one of those would work in this kind of new construct that lets Donald Trump get to 270, you know, without Virginia, which I think is the one state where he appears to be alive.
All right, Roger Stone, stay right there. We'll be back with the former campaign manager for Donald Trump to talk about the incredible things that are happening with 48 days left. Fourth hour starts now. Infowars.com/show for some stations that don't carry it. Roger Stone switching to a better computer on Skype. Let's take a phone call right now. Paul Watson's getting in the chair. He's going to co-host this hour with us. A lot is happening right now. In fact, Stone is now back in his chair. We've got Dwayne in Canada, been holding for quite a while. We've got Uncle Sam in Louisiana. We're going to get to all of you. Roger, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Let me ask you this question. I keep asking it every week of you. How are they going to counterstrike? Hillary seems desperate now. Her eyes aren't pointing the right direction. There's a video of that. She seems totally panicked. There's articles in Politico where the Democrats are, quote, panicking, as you said last week, but now they admit total panic. And then to see the Democratic nominee claiming the Russians are behind bombings in America, I mean, this seems to have entered lunatic land. Will the Democrats kick her out, remove her? Because we've heard talk of that.
No, I don't think that will happen. I think she could only remove herself. I can answer your question, though, in terms of what they're going to do. In 1982, the Republican National Committee signed a consent decree with the federal court in which they, in essence, agreed not to combat or even seek voter fraud out. This was after the aftermath of the 1981 New Jersey gubernatorial election. Therefore, the Democrats could go to court slightly before the election, just days before the election, make the argument that the Republican National Committee was an extension of the Trump campaign. He is, after all, the Republican nominee for president. And prevent the kind of stop the steal activities in the at the polling places that we have talked about on this show. This consent decree is a ticking time bomb for the Republicans.
So to be clear, correct me if I'm wrong, we come out, we say, well, what for fraud Trump does a month and a half ago. The feds, the president say that doesn't exist. They panic, though, knowing we're going to be watching. So now they're going to federalize it to keep it safe. That means cover up their steal.
Well, not only federalize it to keep it safe, as I said on this show, watch it, but disarm us entirely through this consent decree, which the Republicans agreed to in 1982. It is therefore, if we did anything theoretically under the decree, we'd be violating. This is, I think, a giant problem for the Republicans.
So what keeps you up at night? Trump's clearly going from a surge to a wave to a tsunami, but it's not in the bag yet.
Well, I'm feeling growingly confident. I think for the first time I said on this show last week that I am confident now that he will win. Now it's a question of holding on to it. The momentum is in his direction, and I expect that to continue. However, we have three debates coming up. None of the moderators are friendly to Donald Trump. Trump himself preferred no moderator. He'd like to just go at it with Hillary like Lincoln and Douglas. I agree with that idea. I think it is outrageous that the Libertarian Party and Green Party candidates are not allowed to participate. The Presidential Commission on Debates is not appointed by the president, not a commission, and not about debate. It's about limiting debate. The idea that a candidate can't get on the ballot unless they have 15%, and they can't get 15% unless they, get in the debates unless they have 15%, and they can't get 15% unless they're in the debates. That's problematic. I understand Gary Johnson's supporters are having a demonstration tomorrow outside the Presidential Commission on Debates office in Washington, D.C. Frankly, even though I'm 100% for Donald Trump, I wish I could join them. I think that it would actually be a net positive politically for Trump if Jill Stein and Gary Johnson were both in the debates.
I'll say this. I'm always for third parties being involved, but clearly Donald Trump has taken over a major party, and I would basically see Johnson as the establishment coming in and taking over the Libertarians. But regardless, I'm going to come back with Paul Watson. He's got some key questions. And then I've been asking the questions, Roger Stone. You were hot to get on today. Usually I'm begging you to come on the show. So I want to hear what you have to say, what the big news is that you haven't gotten to yet. Straight ahead, Roger Stone from the StoneColdTruths.com is our guest. I'm Alex Jones with Infowars.com. Paul Joseph Watson from London is straight ahead. All right, we got former head of the Trump campaign, Roger Stone, great patriot, best-selling author. We got Paul Watson, who was supposed to host this fourth hour, but I'm co-hosting in the first 20 minutes or so. Joining us from London, England, or he may be in France. He's always in different parts of the world. Superstar journalist, as he tells the truth and is a patriot. And we've got a bunch of callers. We've got a lot to cover. I've got a lot of other questions for you, Roger Stone, but as we turn to the three-shot here for TV viewers at Infowars.com/show, and before Paul comes in and asks his questions, you said big news today. In the last 10 minutes, I was asking my questions. What's front and center for you right now as Donald Trump is clearly way ahead in the polls?
Well, I thought it was very significant that last week when Trump pulled ahead in the polls, you'll notice that the Hillary campaign at first tried to resurrect David Duke as an issue. When that got no traction, we went all the way back to birtherism. This is because some Clinton campaign poll somewhere shows that this damages Donald Trump among some voters. I was particularly proud of Trump in the way that he turned this back. First of all, he just said flatly, okay, Obama was born here, but the person who started this, who started the entire birther genre.
And I love how they had to deny it. Even Politico had to admit it was Democrats. I remember, but sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, and in PolitiFacts, which is now been caught being wrong a couple times, supposedly the arbiter of what's true, and CNN both insist, no, Hillary's people did not start the...
That's like Snopes is run by a fat lady with a cat, so she knows everything?
Well, here's what I do know. Mark Penn writes about Obama's birth and strategy memo, and Sidney Blumenthal, the Democrat dirty trickster, guy who thinks he's Ted Sorensen, but he's really Dick Tuck, was promulgating this and pushing it hard.
Sure, and what do you make, as you were saying that 2 weeks ago, what do you make of CNN having to admit, headline, no, Hillary did start the birth amendment? I mean, I was there in 2008. She did it.
Yeah, although I read the CNN story conversely, I thought they were once again trying to absolve her. The point I'm making, Alex, is the level of desperation. David Duke, birtherism. None of these things are relevant to making this country great again, to getting an economic resurgence in this country that will make us strong again, that will allow us to rebuild our national defense. There is absolute palpable panic among the Democrats because, as we saw only a month ago, they were using the LBJ Barry Goldwater playbook. Remember, the media said
nuclear war, the countdown, the daisy petals were all dead.
Right, and that has failed utterly to their shock.
So I ask the question again, Paul Watson, and then I want you to ask your questions of your host in this hour, Paul Watson from London. How do you see them striking back? I mean, they're clearly in full panic mode, like Stone said last week. Politico today admits, CNN, Democrats in panic. I mean, it says they're panicking. What's happening?
Well, you've got, as you said earlier, Alex, Bloomberg reporters asking Hillary, was the ISIS attack staged, funded, provocateured by Russia? While Russia is bombing ISIS, it's okay for the mainstream media to engage in the most flagrant, bizarre conspiracy theories while attacking us for talking about Hillary's health, which we've been completely vindicated on. Of course, it was our video that went viral that reignited that issue about 6 weeks ago. You're talking about they're desperate, how they're going to strike back. I think, and this is what happened before Brexit, remember, we had Joe Cox, this anti-Brexit MP that was murdered in the street by this unstable, racist, pro-Brexiteer person. Of course, turned out he was just a mentally unstable individual, not even really political, but that didn't matter. For the final 2 weeks before the Brexit vote, the media hammered on this narrative because they've got still a complete lack of self-awareness. They don't know that just calling their opponents racist doesn't work anymore. But they still hammered on that rhetoric that anyone who supported Brexit was a racist right-wing extremist. Why did Hillary start talking about the alt-right in that infamous speech now?
I agree. What you're about to say is they're planting the ground right now for the claims that we want to kill Hillary, we're violent. We see when Trump says, hey, if I can't have bodyguards, you shouldn't have them. They're spinning everything into we want to kill Hillary. Is that what you're getting at? So a staged assassination attempt.
Well, it doesn't have to be against Hillary. She planted that meme that the alt-right was unhinged, was dangerous, was extremist. You've got her official campaign website talking about Pepe the Frog, for God's sake. People kept asking, why is she doing that? Why is she doing the one thing that you don't do, which is to feed the trolls? Well, it wasn't really to counter that narrative. It was to set the stage to create this narrative that there's going to be an unhinged, racist, right-wing extremist.
So she can censor the internet.
Yeah, so you could have a Trump-supporting, MAGA hat-wearing, Pepe the Frog-memeing white supremacist, going to a school in a black area of the country.
No, I think you're right. It'll be someone in a full Pepe Frog outfit attacking a black school.
Yeah, and, the media has created the environment where that doesn't have to be even contrived. It doesn't have to be a conspiracy. If you lecture people all day, as the media and the left have done, they've pushed this narrative that Donald Trump is literally Hitler and that his supporters are brown shirt Nazis. Not only does that embolden extremists on the left who threaten and in some cases plan to assassinate Trump, it emboldens actual neo-Nazis who think they can...
That's right. I agree. Let's get Roger Stone's take on this. We're skipping this network break, and then we're going to... Stone, I'll leave it about 10 minutes. Paul will take over. What do you make of that? I mean, how will they strike back? Is that a valid point?
I totally agree with Paul's analysis. First, they're going to try to remove our poll watchers. That's the point I was making about the consent decree, to allow them to steal at will. And as I said last week, I still fear for Trump's safety as the bankers and the financial interests in this country and the globalists get more panicky and they realize what a threat to them Donald Trump is. The thing that leaves me awake at night worrying is about his personal safety. Now, I don't rule out that they might try to stage some assault on Hillary, but sadly, I think an attempt to kill Trump is not outside the realm. Now, people are going to call me a conspiracy theorist right up until the time that somebody tries this. So I pray for Trump every night.
I agree. We have the New York Times and others calling for the assassination of Trump. If he gets assassinated or somebody tries to, they're going to have blood on their hands.
There's no question about that. But the hysteria is out of control. Alex, If you go on Twitter today, there are literally thousands of tweets accusing me of planting the bomb in New York City.
I know. No, they're saying I did it. You did it. The Russians did it. I mean, because Trump says we're bringing in millions of radical Muslims, so we're going to end up getting attacks. And then when he's right, it's our fault. We must have done it. No, these Muslims really do this. They're at war with logic. It's like Muslims can't do terror, Hillary. Isn't it really the Russians?
Well, and the insinuation that you or I or anyone who supports Trump is behind the bombing, when you go look a little closer, they're all bots. They're all automated. This is a David Brock operation. Brock is the Joseph Goebbels of
the... And by the way, talking about Brock, he admits he's offering all this money for, quote, data on Trump. I'm tempted to offer $1 million for data on Hillary and Clinton, and there'll be a graduated stage. If we use it, 10,000. If it's huge, 50,000. But the coup de grace, I'm thinking about my October surprise. I think I'm going to launch it next week. $1 million for dirt on the Clintons to be released. What do you think?
Well, I'd be the first one to apply, Alex, because I've got plenty.
I know you do. By the way, we should talk later. You know, I've got a little September surprise planned for later in the week.
Well, look, I still think that the Haiti scandal is not fully exposed. The way the Clintons have raped the Haitian people, they were in charge, essentially. They took the lead.
They only gave 5% of the $100 million they raised to the people. That is incredible.
George H.W. Bush today says he's going to vote for Hillary. Wow, no surprise there. The Bush-Clinton crime syndicate are the ones most responsible for the rape of Haiti. The Bush-Clinton Haiti Fund is the biggest scam that they've pulled together. So the establishment's circling the wagons. No surprise there.
By the way, another added plus, as you know, new DC leaks, new WikiLeaks, and others coming out, more coming out soon. With the whole Republican establishment, Bohemian Grove, you know, Colin Powell saying, oh, God, the Republican establishment hates him. I mean, isn't that more just a certification that Trump's the real deal?
Yes, and I still believe that the entire backstory on Libya is going to hit the fan shortly. And we're going to have a reexamination of whether the removal of Gaddafi and the billion-dollar war that we staged in that country was worth it and what it was really all about. So I still think that Hillary's got some very tough patches ahead.
Well, she doesn't look as arrogant now, and it's metaphysical that she's collapsing. Paul Watson, you're taking over here in just a few minutes, but other questions for Roger Stone or comments, Paul Watson?
Yeah, the other comment is with this October surprise, of course, Hillary linked to the alt-right, said it was basically controlled by Putin. We know that they've considered having provocations where they send up a jet painted in UN colors, have Saddam Hussein shoot it down back in 2002 to start the Iraq war. That was in the Downing Street memo. You know, Hillary has linked Putin to Trump, said that he's cozying up to Putin. So could they have an event, a provocation with Russia? You know, Syria's heating up. We had Russia supposedly bomb a UN aid convoy. We had the US bomb Syrian troops in Syria. Could they have a military confrontation with Russia, you know, a shoot down of a Russian or an American jet?
That's a good question. That's a good question. Let me ask you this. You wrote about the CNN professor globalist saying some big surprise is coming in the next month that'll challenge Trump and Hillary. You were saying you thought it could be, I mean, a couple different things, but what else could it be? What about financial collapse, Paul?
It could be anything. I think it's more likely to be, you know, a racial attack caught on camera, you know, Trump supporters beating up African-Americans, Rodney King style. It could be anything along those lines. It could be a confrontation with Russia. And don't put it past them. I mean, the Clintons are completely ruthless.
They'll do anything. Sure. Hire a couple criminals. Tell them you're going to go to, you know, jail for 6 months, but we're going to give you millions of dollars. Of course, the criminals will be killed in jail, and have them go beat up some little black kids at a bus stop. That'd be perfect. Wouldn't it, Roger Stone?
Yeah, look, I think they're capable of absolutely anything. And having the CIA director come out last week and say that he fears that the Russians are going to hack and rig our elections, this is the same CIA director who told us when the 9/11 28 pages were released by the Congress several weeks ago that they didn't say what they said.
That's right.
That the Saudi royal family and their retainers finance the attack on America.
That's right. He said it doesn't say the Saudis royals funded it when it said in clear English they did.
Yeah. So this guy has no credibility. He's now been politicized the same way the FBI director has been politicized. And the Russian meme is one that clearly must be showing in their polling as one that you can fool people with. Donald Trump's an American patriot. He's not in league with Putin. He's never even met Putin. He is, while he's praised his qualities as a leader, he's criticized his philosophy and his ways.
And Hillary's been caught getting 30 plus million to give him one fifth of our uranium and all these other deals. The truth is she's the one up to her eyeballs in all of it. What about this issue? Regardless of what happens to Hillary or even Trump, Roger Stone and Paul Watson as well, do you agree with me that we're seeing the death of the dinosaur media and the establishment? Whatever comes out of this, it's a Pyrrhic victory, just like the British Empire won World War I, but it actually killed their empire. Isn't this the type of victory you win the war, but then you end up losing right after the war?
This is only possible because of the technological changes in America. The fact that half the voters are now getting their information right here on their handheld device on demand when they want to. And this has taken the power away from broadcast television and away from cable, ironically. This is the wave of the future. We don't have to go through CBS to reach the voters anymore. InfoWars is reaching them as we speak. And this lack of control is driving the establishment insane. That's why they want to regulate.
I was about to say, make no mistake, if they steal it from Trump, the next order of business, and we're going to Paul Watson, is coming after Drudge, Alex Jones, Roger Stone, Breitbart. Do you agree with that?
Roger? Without any question.
Paul Watson.
I've already experienced it. I'm banned on CNN.
You've been hacked.
I'm banned on MSNBC. Because they don't, like Jack Nicholson said in A Few Good Men, they can't handle the truth.
You want the truth? You can't handle the truth. Paul Watson, I'm going to hand the baton to you here in a moment, but final questions for Roger Stone while we have him here.
Final questions would be, I mean, we had WikiLeaks and Julian Assange back, 10 days ago now, say that their next huge reveal was coming out in the next week. That seems to be delayed again. When do you think the next big email leak or document batch drop will happen, you know, coming from WikiLeaks? When do you think we can expect that?
I have reason to believe that it is imminent. I think for ethical reasons, they like to put out emails in blocks that are complete so that there's not any one email that is misleading or gives the wrong impression. There's a lot of integrity in the way they are leaking this information. Now, there's been a great campaign online to try to disparage and discredit Assange, which is kind of funny because the left loved him when he was exposing the Bush administration.
Yeah, at this point, he's got complete credibility. He's a hero.
Yeah, there's no question. He's a truth teller and a hero.
Yeah, I mean, I said time will tell because I said, hey, I hate Bush. Good job. But I said, if you don't go after Democrats later, he did, even more than Bush. And he says Hillary is a literal demon. I mean, what does that tell us, Roger Stone?
No, I think that's exactly right. What's interesting here is the establishment doesn't understand that George Bush the elder endorsing Hillary merely confirms for the voters that the political class.
You said it. I was going to ask you that question. That's the one question I forgot. Roger Stone, StoneColdTruth.com, best-selling author. His books, by the way, are available at InfoWarsStore.com. Doesn't it show the total gulf and disconnect that some addled, you know, disconnected space cadet at 90 years old thinks it's going to help Hillary endorsing her? I mean, it gives me hope to know these guys are not all powerful. They may have all the wizardry of NSA technology, but they don't know how to use it. It's like a monkey trying to fly a spaceship.
Well, and look, I'm telling you, Laura Bush is in the wings. She's going to endorse Hillary. That's coming. No, they're tone deaf. The Bushes have always been tone deaf, and they're discredited. Their presidencies are both failures, abject failures, but they don't get it. You see, the people are on to them.
Yeah, they don't know their name is shit.
No, and the people have figured out that it's really one party. It's a two-party duopoly. Trump's nomination is the hostile takeover of the Republican
Party. That's right.
Party.
He's the beautiful fall of this kleptocratic system. It'll be up to us. I've said this, though, and I want Paul to have the final question, Roger. A great interview today, by the way. I think the best ever. if Trump, and that means us, don't deliver, and we don't really try to make change, and we don't really cut taxes and empower the economy and do all this, the country's doomed. I mean, this is a magic moment that's happening. If he gets in, we've got to make this work. We've got to deliver. If we do same old, I'm going to give up.
Yeah, but I got to tell you, I've known Donald Trump for 40 years. This is a guy who is incredibly stubborn. He knows what his agenda is, and he's not going to waver from it. And he understands that if he delivers on his agenda, he will go down in history as one of the greatest presidents we've ever had.
That's right.
And if he lets the establishment co-opt his agenda or sideline his agenda, then he won't. He's a patriot. He's running because he loves his country, not because he has to be president to be somebody. He already is somebody. So he doesn't want the job for the job's sake, like George H.W. Bush, who believed in nothing. He's doing this at great cost.
Well, I totally agree with you. And look at his work ethic. Look at all the great coups he's done, from Mexico to meeting with the Egyptian president to fight radical Islam to going to New Orleans. The arrogance of the current elite is what's frightening to me. They're totally disconnected. Paul Watson, final question before you take over with Roger Stone.
Well, I completely agree. There's a total lack of self-awareness. They think they can bring down Trump by continually claiming that he's this racist demagogue. You know, if it wasn't Trump, it would be someone else. This populist wave, this people's insurgency against the political class, has swept the West for the past 2, 3, 4 years. It didn't just arrive with Donald Trump. So if they think they can tear down this whole movement by just calling Trump a demagogue and a racist, they've got another thing coming. It's a complete lack of self-awareness. You know, the media got caught with Hillary's health, dismissing it as a conspiracy theory. She came out, she collapsed. They said, oh my God, we got rumbled. This was actually true. That was a shining example of their complete lack of self-awareness. It cost them with Brexit, where they thought they could defeat us just by calling us all racist.
Sure, and they're saying nobody knows what election fraud is, and a month later they're federalizing the election.
Well, not only that. If you can go back 3 years ago to an interview I did on CNN with Brian Stelter, in which I told him that Hillary had significant health problems, that they were degenerative, that it may even made it likely she might not make the race, but if she did, they would hamper her campaign. And he, of course, dismissed all that and attacked me. It was all unfounded.
And now it's prophecy.
My sources were impeccable. They were high society New York Democrats, and they were right.
And now the emails with Colin Powell and others are high-level Democrats going, she can't walk up three steps. She's what the hell's going on with her? And Powell's like, I know. Everybody tells me she's dying. The Secret Service doesn't know. They just say she's collapsing every 20, 30 minutes. I mean, and we told you this a month ago, and then it happens, folks. This is real. Roger Stone, thank you so much. Please pop back in as soon as you've got more intel. Thank you so much. We'll talk to you soon.
I'm headed back to Trump Tower right now.
All right. Very exciting. All right. Going back to Paul Joseph Watson. Paul, thank you. I didn't mean to cut in 30 minutes to your hour, but you co-hosted with us. I'd love to have you co-host 5 days a week if you would. So much happening. I know you have you ask me anything coming up soon. We also have 20% off of Supermel Vitality, which ends today, helps fund the operation. We have the new free app out. Paul Watson, take over. God bless you.
Okay, there goes Alex Jones. We're coming up on the break, but after we come back, we're going to get back into this huge October surprise news. Hillary Clinton is a cornered animal. She's dangerous. She's desperate. She's ruthless. What kind of dirty tricks, what kind of stunts could they pull? We'll be back. We're back live on the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show. We're going to hit some news here in a moment, but again, just going back to what we were covering in the last segment, Hillary Clinton is desperate. The polls are tightening. She's absolutely ruthless. She's desperate. As I said, before the Brexit vote in the United Kingdom, we had this incident which was relentlessly exploited by the mainstream media, by the left, by the anti-Brexit crowd, where this mentally ill, unstable individual went out, murdered someone on the street. That someone happened to be an anti-Brexit leftist MP. The gas mileage they got out of that in the week that followed, right up until the Brexit vote, was huge. It almost swung it for them. Again, they didn't realize that constantly demonizing their political opposition as racists and bigots doesn't work anymore. That only influences weak-minded people who are probably going to vote for that side anyway. And again, it didn't work for them. But we could see it again with Hillary. This is a very real possibility that you could have some kind of violent incident blamed on a Donald Trump supporter a few days or a week before the election. Again, they've been setting the stage for months. You saw it again on the Emmys. What was it last night, a couple of nights ago, where, you know, they're getting up on stage and again saying that Donald Trump is literally Hitler. If you create that kind of political environment, you embolden extremists, not only on the left, and we've had people threatening to assassinate Trump. You see it on Twitter every day. We had the guy who actually went to a Trump rally, the British guy, Sanford, I think his name was, who, you know, tried to grab an officer's gun, tried to assassinate Trump. But you will get it on the other side as well. You will get actual neo-Nazis that want to act out this bizarre dream that they have of, you know, greasing the skids for the reincarnation of Adolf Hitler or whatever demented dream they have. And again, the media is responsible for creating that environment with this completely reckless rhetoric. So you could have an incident where a MAGA hat wearing, you know, Pepe the Frog memeing Trump supporter acts out, you know, a white supremacist, whether the incident is contrived or not. Again, doesn't have to be a conspiracy, doesn't have to be a false flag for one of these individuals who is already on the fringe to go postal. And of course, Hillary Clinton will swoop in to political point score off such an incident. Again, why is she talking about the alt-right? Why is her official campaign website posting articles about a cartoon frog? This isn't for nothing. They've thought about this. They're setting the stage for this. This is nowhere near outside the realm of possibility, you know, that you could have a group, a mob of Trump supporters allegedly caught on camera beating up an African American. And if this happens, if this is the October surprise, you know, it's imminent here within the next month to 6 weeks. And this is surely what's going to happen. It happened right before Brexit. The other scenario is, again, you've had Hillary say, Vladimir Putin is the leader of the alt-right. Donald Trump is cozying up to Vladimir Putin. Again, you've seen what happened in Syria. Massive escalation. The US bombs Syrian troops. Russia allegedly bombs UN aid convoys. You could have an incident where a Russian fighter jet or an American fighter jet gets shot down in Syria. And again, a huge military escalation, a huge provocation. Hillary grandstands, says that Trump is anti-American because he's cozying up to the dictator that hates America, Vladimir Putin. That, again, is a very real possibility as we count down to the final weeks of this presidential race, with the polls tightening, with Hillary Clinton now doing just one event. Again, what is it, 48... 49, 50 days to go to the election. Over the next 6 days, she's doing just one event. The polls are basically neck and neck now, and she's more absent from the campaign trail. Again, because she's breaking down, because she's having these coughing fits, because she's collapsing. In the most intense phase of the race, she's disappearing. She's getting more desperate. She's a cornered animal. So don't think for a second that this couldn't happen. In fact, it would be completely naive to think that it wouldn't, given what we've seen in the past. Given that back in 2004, just days before that presidential election, we had Osama bin Laden pop up on tape and basically encourage people to vote for John Kerry when he was running against George W. Bush. You know, Walter Cronkite commented that this was so convenient for Bush that it almost looked like a Karl Rove setup. Afterwards, both Bush and Kerry said that that victory for George W. Bush was swung by that Osama bin Laden videotape. So there is precedent for this. You don't always get a big October surprise that swings the presidential election, but it can and it has happened. So yes, we could have documents coming from WikiLeaks. We could have hacked emails, but from the opposite direction, we could also see Hillary Clinton's campaign contrive, exploit, provocateur, some kind of violent incident to be blamed on Trump and his supporters, or some kind of military escalation provocation with Russia. And again, when I put out a video on this, like I did with Hillary's health, which went viral, the media is going to call it a conspiracy theory, just like they called questions over Hillary's health a conspiracy theory. of course, we were completely vindicated on that. And the media had to scuttle away with their tails tucked between their legs, admitting that they got it completely wrong. So there's a video coming out on that tomorrow in which we will delve into the possible scenarios for the October surprise. So that's going to be a really important video to get out to people. And of course, we've got another big expose of Hillary Clinton coming up probably on Thursday. Again, unknown, unseen information involving whistleblowers. It's going to be a big story. And I encourage everyone to get that out, but more on that later on in the week. As for now, we've got a top story up on Infowars.com. Another exclusive, which the media will claim is a conspiracy theory, but we've got the video. Exclusive leaked video shows Obama railing against white people during Kenya trip. Now, this is from 1990, but again, never before seen video. It's Obama in his 20s on a trip to Kenya with Michelle Obama, and he's basically denouncing white people, railing against white privilege. Now, the video isn't out yet. It's going to be out exclusively on Infowars.com in the pretty near future. But we've got an exclusive quote from that video in which Obama says, quote, "I'm deeply saddened by a sense that whites are still superior in this country, in some sense that if you sit at a restaurant, they're served before a Kenyan is served. If you go through customs, a white person is going to have an easier time going through customs." So again, it emphasizes the point that Obama was obsessed with this race baiting many, many years before he came into office. And of course, he's turned out to be the divider in chief. Race relations in America, you know, the worst they've been for decades. You've got him cozying up, him embracing Black Lives Matter, a George Soros funded group, which is not grassroots. It's completely AstroTurf. Again, their ideological inspiration, Assata Shakur, is a convicted cop killer who is on the FBI's most wanted domestic terrorist list. We've seen their supporters kill cops in Dallas, in other cities. This is a divisive group. It's controlled from the top. In fact, you had original Black Lives Matter activists, one that was killed recently, come out and call them out for what they were. Again, a top-down controlled movement to stoke more racial division in America. And Obama was into that from the very beginning, which is why this video is very revealing. Now, they're trying to crowdfund its release because it literally cost them $10,000 just to get a private eye to get this video out, which is filmed, in fact, by Obama's sister. So, again, that video is going to be exclusively on Infowars.com as soon as that target for the crowdfunding is met, which you can, you know, you can help support that in the article. There's a link to that. So again, damning proof that Obama was obsessed with race baiting years and years before he took office at the White House. Again, that's another Infowars.com exclusive with the comments in the article. Moving on, let's get to Hillary's health now. Of course, again, we got the viral video out. It was an issue, but we reignited the issue about 6 weeks ago now with that viral video that got nearly 5 million views now. Mystery, and this is at the top of Drudge Report, what was going on with Hillary's eyes during Philly speech? This is out of the American Mirror. During a speech in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania on Monday, Democratic presidential nominee Hillary Clinton appeared to have something quite off about her appearance. And you can view the video, it's up on Infowars.com. Hillary's eyes appeared not in sync with one another as the left eye looked to be cockeyed and displaced, especially as she looked towards the left. A montage of Hillary's eye-catching moments before a small group of Temple University students can be seen in the footage. And again, one eye is off in one direction, another is off in the other direction. Absolutely bizarre footage, given that it's complemented by all these other issues, of course, by Hillary's major collapse in New York just a couple of weeks ago. Jimmy Fallon had to help Hillary onto the Tonight Show stage. Again, this is out of the American Mirror. During Hillary Clinton's entrance on The Tonight Show, host Jimmy Fallon, who of course was panned merely for having Donald Trump on his show a few days ago, gave her a firm grasp and hand up two stairs onto the stage, just two steps. And sick Hillary Clinton had trouble making it onto the stage. Here's Mark Dice with some commentary on that clip.
Jimmy Fallon had to literally help Hillary Clinton climb onto the stage on The Tonight Show on Monday. She wasn't wearing high heels, so either Jimmy Fallon is sexist, thinking that a woman can't walk up two simple steps on her own 2 feet, or Hillary Clinton, as she's been shown in the past, has a hard time maintaining her balance and climbing up stairs or standing for long periods of time. Have a look at the clip here. He disguises his help as just a simple handshake, but as you can clearly see, he is helping her up. You can see he's actually biting his lip, trying to cover up his smirk as he realizes that he has to help this poor woman step up 2 simple steps. Meanwhile, Donald Trump is climbing over concrete barriers while he was campaigning after a mob of thugs blocked a freeway earlier this summer during one of his campaign events. Last week, when Fallon had Donald Trump on the show, liberals absolutely freaked out, and it was trending because they thought that they treated, quote, Hitler too nice. Hillary Clinton's pre-planned jokes written by the studio fell flat and barely got any laughter out of the audience. And Jimmy Fallon wore a surgical mask as soon as she came onto stage because he was afraid to get sick. As most people know now, Hillary Clinton has serious health problems, despite the campaign and the liberal media claiming for months that it was just a conspiracy theory. Now, after the shocking footage of her collapse at the 9/11 memorial, her coughing fits, and her pneumonia, people now are starting to realize something is seriously wrong with Hillary Clinton. Still unable to step up 2 simple short steps to get onto the Tonight Show stage. I'm Mark Dice. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel here if you're new and stay tuned. New reports every day. So I'll see you soon.
Okay, there's Mark Dice with commentary on sick Hillary's latest medical episode. Another headline out of American Mirror, mystery. Again, we've covered that. Jimmy Fallon helps Hillary up on Tonight Show stage. We've had Mark Dice's commentary on that. Here's another headline. Tired? After today, Hillary has nothing on public calendar until debate in 6 days. So 49, 50 days before the presidential election. But that's not stopping Hillary Clinton from apparently laying low for the next 6 of them. Clinton held a rally at Temple University, and according to her public schedule posted at hillaryspeeches.com, she has nothing public planned until the first presidential debate on September 26th. So again, you've got these polls tightening, the race virtually neck and neck. You would think that Hillary, to the best of her ability, given that she's a walking zombie now apparently, would at least be maintaining the same schedule, but she's going to be even more absent from the campaign trail, even as she's lost her lead over Donald Trump. What does that tell you about her medical state? Again, they can't legitimately dismiss it as a conspiracy theory anymore, and we've had more and more examples of that over the past few days. Let's get to another article out of LiveZet. NYC mayor says Islamic terror vanishingly rare. In the wake of a radical Islamic terrorist attack on New York City, which was a bombing. Yes, I use the politically incorrect term bombing. CNN says you can't do that anymore. You know, BBC says using the word terrorist is politically incorrect, but we're going to continue to do it because we're interested in reality. In the wake of a radical Islamic terrorist attack on New York City, Mayor Bill de Blasio is telling citizens not to worry about the threat of jihadist violence and pushing for even more questionably vetted migrants to be resettled in the United States. Now, again, he was visited by the mayor of Paris, which I was in Paris a couple of weeks ago, is now basically an open-air migrant camp. You've got migrants, mostly men, 99% men, with mattresses just splayed out in the middle of the street, sitting there all day. It's an open-air migrant camp. You've got the mayor of the Islamic Caliphate of London, Sadiq Khan, also writing an editorial, again, with Bill de Blasio, New York mayor, in which they say that militant violence is vanishingly rare. Vanishingly rare from refugees, from migrants, despite the fact that we've had this wave of attacks in Europe. Again, Germany, 3 in a row a couple of months ago. And again, they've come out with this big op-ed saying that mass migration is a positive thing. This is the quote from the article, and we're going to go through some of them.
Refugees and other foreign-born residents bring needed skills and enhance the vitality and growth of local economies. That's what Mayor Bill de Blasio and Sadiq Khan said in this editorial. Well, the problem with that is the fact completely contradicts it. Out of the 1 million refugees coming into Germany, as the FT reported last month, only 63 have been employed. Yeah, that's really revitalizing the economy, isn't it? That's really putting these people to work. Again, look at Sweden. 58% of welfare payments in Sweden go to immigrants, who represent just 16% of the population. So how in any way is that revitalizing the population? Quote, it's wrong to characterize immigrant communities as dangerous, said Khan and de Blasio, in reference to these millions of Muslim migrants pouring into Europe. And if Hillary Clinton gets into office, pouring in at record numbers into the US. Well, again, there's a problem with that. It's called the fact. German crime wave. New data. Crime rates in Germany would have remained roughly static since 2014, yet the country recorded an extra 402,000 crimes committed by migrants over the past year. So again, completely disproven by the facts. Migrants are responsible for 95% of all crimes in Sweden, overrepresented by 430%. Yet Khan de Blasio say that it's perfectly safe. We need to bring in more. We'll be back. We're back on the final segment of the Alex Jones Show. Now, before we go back to the news, I'd just like to mention that we've got a special at InfoWarsLife.com that ends tonight. This must end tonight, so take advantage while you can. And it is 20% off Super Male Vitality. We're close to selling out. This is going to finish completely by tonight. Now is the last chance to secure your bottle for 20% off and stock up while supplies last. Again, read the 5-star reviews at InfoWarsLife.com and purchase the products to support the growth of this network. We're not funded by George Soros like Black Lives Matter. We're not funded by giant pharmaceutical companies like CNN. We're not funded by the corrupt government of Bahrain like CNN. We're funded by you, and we're beholden to you. You allow us to expand. You allow us to send out reporters into the field and take on the mainstream media directly, which has led to the complete collapse in American confidence in the mainstream media now that we have a real alternative. And it's all thanks to you getting the products, helping us build InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, Super Male Vitality, 20% off special. That must end tonight. Let's get into a few final news stories here. CNN puts words in Trump's mouth, runs headline saying he wants, quote, racial profiling. CNN has once again come under fire for manipulating the news to fit its own agenda, as the network ran headlines saying that GOP nominee Donald Trump called for racial profiling to combat terrorism. There's just one problem with that. He never used the words race. He never used the word racial. He was talking about how Israel profiles to catch terrorists based on their behavior if they're acting suspiciously, not on their race. But CNN flashed up the words racial profiling over and over again. CNN, you know, they did it with the bombing in New York. Hillary Clinton came out and said, this bombing. They then savaged Donald Trump for calling it a bombing, despite the fact that Hillary had done the same and edited out the clip of her doing so. Now CNN is openly faking quotes and attributing them to Donald Trump to make him look bad. Again, dispensed with any semblance of neutrality and impartiality. Now they're just brazenly inventing things that he didn't say to make him look bad. Let that sink in. Now we got another story related to Trump Jr. in this case. And again, if leftists got as upset about Islamic terrorism than they do Skittles memes, then maybe ISIS would be in more trouble than they are, because that is what triggered leftists this morning. Donald Trump Jr. tweeted out an image of a bowl of Skittles with the quote, if I had a bowl of Skittles and I told you just three would kill you, would you take a handful? That's our Syrian refugee problem. Absolute explosion of outrage. Donald Trump Jr. is the worst thing ever for tweeting out a meme about Skittles.
Of course, he underplayed the problem because, as polls show, 21% of Syrian migrants support ISIS. So it's not just a few Skittles in a bowl of 100 Skittles. It's actually 1 in 5 of them support ISIS. So he actually underestimated the problem, but now he's an evil bigot and a racist for tweeting out a meme of Skittles. Of course, Hillary Clinton, the policies that she supported led to the destruction of Syria, led to thousands of deaths, led to the international migrant crisis. But that's okay. Donald Trump Jr.'s bad because he tweeted out a Skittles meme. And that is what has triggered leftists today. Again, if they were as upset about Islamic terrorism as they are Skittles memes, ISIS would be in a lot more trouble. That's going to wrap it up this edition of The Alex Jones Show. Alex will be back 11 to 2 tomorrow. InfoWars Nightly News is coming up, and all the breaking news is on InfoWars.com.